วันนี้ค่ะก่อนจะเข้าสู่พิธีการสำคัญนะคะนั่นคือพิธีเปิดนะคะก่อนอื่นต้องขออนุญาตแขกท่านผู้มีเกียรติทุกท่านนะคะที่จะแนะนำกิจกรรมต่างๆในการประชุมในครั้งนี้นะคะหลังจากที่ลงทะเบียนเสร็จแล้วนะคะเราจะมีการกล่าวรายงานโดยอาจารย์ชูศักดิ์นะคะหลังจากนั้นก็มีการกล่าวเปิดงานโดยท่านอาจารย์วิพันธ์สังคหพงศ์นะคะก่อนที่จะเริ่มเข้าสู่ในส่วนของงานวิชาการนะคะหัวข้อในช่วงเช้าของวันนี้นะคะมีทั้งหมด4หัวข้อนะคะเราจะมีการพักเบรกประมาณ15นาทีนะคะในช่วงเวลา 10:15 หลังจากนั้นนะคะช่วงพักกลางวันนะคะเราจะมีลันช์เลคเชอร์นะคะโดยรับประทานอาหารภายในห้องประชุมนะคะอาหารเบรกจัดที่บริเวณด้านนอกนะคะการลงทะเบียนนะคะ CNE นะคะต้องลงทะเบียนให้ครบทั้ง2วันนะคะถึงจะได้ CNE ทั้งหมด12หน่วยนะคะอย่าลืมนะคะปิดอุปกรณ์สื่อสารด้วยนะคะเพื่อไม่เป็นการรบกวนบุคคลอื่นนะคะCentral Chest Institute of Thailand Cardiovascular Thoracic Surgery Annual Meeting 2016 in English program. I am Parichan Malison. Today, I get an assigned to be a Master of Ceremony. I work as a nurse in operating theater. First of all, I would like to say thank youall of you to attend this program. For the main topic for this year is update in CABG and in high-risk patients. Please open your mind to get a lot of knowledge from the specialty professor who have a lot of experience. Upon this time occasion, I would like to invite Dr. Chu Sak Kasem San, the head of Department of Cardiovascular Thoracic Surgery, to deliver a speech and notify the purpose for this morning. Dr. Chu Sak, please.
ขอบคุณนะครับนะฮะตอนกล่าวเปิดนี่ขอเป็นภาษาไทยก่อนนะแล้วเดี๋ยวค่อยมาว่ากันภาษาอังกฤษต่อไป เรียนท่านผู้อำนวยการสถาบันโรคทรงอกบุคลากรทางการแพทย์ผู้มาร่วมประชุมทั้งหลายนะครับผมในฐานะที่เป็นตัวแทนของกลุ่มงานศัลยศาสตร์สถาบันโรคทรงอกมีความภูมิใจที่เราได้จัดงานและมีผู้ให้ความสนใจมาร่วมงานของเรานะครับของเราเนี่ยจะแตกต่างไปจากทางอายุรศาสตร์ปอดอายุรศาสตร์หัวใจเพราะอะไรครับเพราะของเขาเนี่ยเป็นคนไข้บุคลากรทางการแพทย์ที่ต้องพบกับคนไข้ที่มาหาจาก OPD หรืออะไรก็ตามแต่จำนวนของคนไข้ในกลุ่มนั้นเนี่ยจะมีมากมายหลากหลายนะครับขณะที่ของเราเนี่ยงานของเราจะลงไปในแนวลึกนะฮะเป็นการต่อยอดมาจากคนไข้ของกลุ่มงานอายุศาสตร์ปอดต่อยอดจากกลุ่มงานของอายุศาสตร์หัวใจเพราะฉะนั้นบุคลากรของเราเนี่ยก็จะจำเพาะอยู่ในการผ่าตัดปอดและหัวใจดังนั้นผมมีความภูมิใจมากถามว่าทำไมนะครับเพราะว่าตั้งแต่ปี2556นะฮะเรามีผู้เข้าร่วมการประชุม281ท่านเป็นบุคลากรภายนอกเนี่ย37ท่านพอปีถัดมาปี57 นะฮะจำนวนคนของที่ร่วมประชุมเท่าๆเดิม278คนแต่มาจากภายนอก85คนและปีที่แล้วนะครับปี58จำนวน281คนเท่าๆเดิมนะฮะแต่บุคลากรจากนอกสถาบันโรคทรวงอกจำนวน93คนจะสังเกตได้ว่าจำนวนบุคลากรภายนอกเพิ่มขึ้นนะฮะนั่นบอกเราว่าการเผยแพร่ความรู้ของการประชุมครั้งนี้เผยแพร่สู่บุคคลภายนอกมากยิ่งขึ้นซึ่งจะเป็นประโยชน์ต่อประเทศชาติต่อคนไข้ส่วนรวมมากยิ่งขึ้นนะฮะผมคิดว่าเราได้เวลาอันสมควรนะฮะธีมในการประชุมครั้งนี้ของเราก็คืออัปเดต in CABG and in high risk patient จะสังเกตได้ว่าหัวข้อเนี่ยจะ อยู่ในเกี่ยวข้องกับการผ่าตัดนะฮะเรามีวิทยากรทั้งหมด27ท่านโดยที่วิทยากรเนี่ยเป็นบุคลากรภายนอกนะฮะจำนวน9คน2คนในนี้มาจากต่างประเทศจากเกาหลีและจากญี่ปุ่นบัดนี้คิดว่าได้เวลาสมควรขอเรียนเชิญท่านผู้อำนวยการสถาบันโรคทรวงอกกล่าวเปิดงานครับ
เรียนท่านผู้จัดการประชุมแล้วก็ผู้เข้าร่วมประชุมทุกท่านนะคะตามที่หัวหน้ากลุ่มงานเศรษฐศาสตร์ได้กล่าวรายงานมานั้นแม้ว่าจะสั้นๆนะคะแต่ก็ได้ใจความว่าท่านภูมิใจนะคะที่จัดงานแล้วมีผู้มาให้ความสนใจนะคะเพราะว่าเรารู้ว่าบุคลากรของเราเนี่ยจะต้องได้รับการพัฒนาทักษะอย่างต่อเนื่องนะคะเพื่อให้สอดคล้องกับนโยบายและพันธกิจของสถาบันนะคะชื่อว่าต้องเป็นความเป็นเลิศด้านการรักษาและการดูแลผู้ป่วยเฉพาะทางด้านโรคหัวใจปอดและหลอดเลือดในระดับนานาชาตินะคะเพราะนั้นในการอบรมครั้งนี้นะคะการประชุมครั้งนี้เราก็ได้รับความร่วมมือจากท่านวิทยากรทั้งหมดเมื่อกี้บอกว่า27ท่านนะคะก็ท่านก็เป็นผู้มีความรู้ความชำนาญในแต่ละด้านที่เกี่ยวกับเรื่องผู้ป่วยโรคหัวใจปอดและหลอดเลือดนะคะทั้งจากภายในและภายนอกและจากต่างประเทศด้วยนะคะจากภายในของเราเราก็คุ้นหน้ากันอยู่นะคะจากภายนอกนี่ก็จะมีของจากคณะแพทยศาสตร์นะคะจุฬาลงกรณ์มหาวิทยาลัยนะคะที่ให้เกียรติมาแล้วก็มีจากภายนอกประเทศอีก2ท่านก็คือจากญี่ปุ่นแล้วก็จากเกาหลีนะคะก็ขอขอบคุณท่านวิทยากรทั้ง27ท่านนะคะ27อรหันต์นะคะและกรรมการจากการประชุมที่ทำให้มีการอบรมในครั้งนี้นะคะขอให้การประชุมอบรมครั้งนี้เนี่ยการประชุมครั้งนี้สำเร็จตามวัตถุประสงค์และขอให้ผู้เข้าร่วมการประชุมทุกท่านเนี่ยทั้งที่เป็นบุคลากรของเราและบุคคลภายนอกนี่ได้นำความรู้จากการประชุมวิชาการครั้งนี้ไปพัฒนาการดูแลผู้ป่วยนะคะเพื่อนำมาซึ่งความเจริญรุ่งเรืองของระบบสาธารณสุขไทยด้วยนะคะก็ขอขอบคุณค่ะแต่ว่าเนื่องจากว่าเราเป็นEnglish version นะคะกล่าวสั้นๆ นิดนึงนะคะเดี๋ยวจะบอกว่าเดี๋ยวเผื่อเกาหลีญี่ปุ่นเดินมาจะได้ยินพอดีนะคะก็Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, this is my pleasure to welcome all of you to our institute.We are here today for 14 CCIT CVT surgery annual meeting, which will extend for the next 2 days. So hope you complete the next 2 days, Okay. And then this meeting is focused on updates CABG and in high-risk patients. And I would like to thank Dr. Shusak and his team of Department of Cardiothoracic Surgery for their efforts in organizing this academic meeting. And last, I would like to extend my deep appreciation to our speaker, especially Associate Professor Dr. Rinleung Lilanukom from Chulalongkorn University and Professor Hiroshi Nimami.And Dr. Chang from Japan and from Korea. Okay. And last but not least, I hope that all of you a great success in this meeting. Thank you very much.
I would like to invite Dr. Vipan Sankahapong and speaker and moderator and head nurse and all of committee to take a photo group proceed on to the stage, please. For the first morning program should be very interesting. The moderator will be Dr. Chusak Sankahapong. Sorry, please forgive me. Dr. Chusak Kasem San. Thank you.
May I start for the morning session? And as I said that already for this meeting, our theme for this meeting is update in CABG and in high risk patient. So the topic for this meeting confined in the chole bypass surgery, that we know that in the past chole bypass ischemic heart disease is quite uncommon for Thai patients, but actually, in my opinion, I think that in the real situation of life, we have silent case a lot. And now, the volume of the operation for the chole bypass surgery increase year by year in every center. So our theme for this year is about the CABG. For the first speaker, we are very proud to have the great speaker that he is the associated professor and head of department of anesthesiology, faculty of medicine, Chulalongkorn University, Dr. Lung Leung, Lun Leung, Leela Nukom. I copy my MC to have some mistake. And his topic for today is how to prevent non-surgical error. Dr. Lin Leung, please.
Hello. ได้ยินไหมครับ Good morning, ladies and gentlemen.
And good morning, Ajahn Pradeep Chai. It's my great honor to be here, to be, this is my first time to become the keynote lecturer in the first session of the meeting. I'm very great honored. My topic will focus on non-technical skill and patient safety. This is, when everybody saw these words, what's that mean? I'm come from Chulalongkorn University and King Chulalongkorn Memorial Hospital, which are very close. They are very close relationship between two organizations. I'm not sure that should I speak in Thai or in English, but I will start in English first, and then if the time is rush or running out of time, I will speed up and maybe go into Thai. Okay, so I have half an hour, right, Ajahn Chusap? I have half an hour, so I will finish by 9:30. Okay. The first, this is a case studies. I will read in Thai. คนไข้ยกตัวอย่างนะครับคนไข้ชื่อนายภาษาไทยวัยรุ่นเคยเห็นเดี๋ยวนี้ภาษาลายเขาจะเขียนกันแปลกๆนะครับเนี่ยคนไข้มาถึง ER โรงพยาบาลแห่งหนึ่งนะครับก็เข็นเข้าไปในโรงพยาบาลชื่อโรงพยาบาลวุ่นวายพอเข็นเข้าไปปุ๊บคนก็ต้องเข้าสู่กระบวนการ resuscitation ใส่ทิวอะไรต่ออะไรเราก็คงคุ้นกับคำนี้นะญาติไปคอยข้างนอกทุกคนก็ทำไปญาติก็ไปเบิกบัตรมาถูกไหมครับญาติก็ไม่ได้ดำคนไข้แย่แล้วก็ไม่ได้นำอะไรมาก็เดินไปเคาน์เตอร์ registration บอกว่าคนไข้ชื่อภาษาไทยวัยรุ่นห้องบัตรก็ภาษาไทยวัยรุ่นก็ค้นปุ๊บออกมาเป็นแบบนี้ครับเห็นอะไรไหมก็ส่งเข้าไปก็รักษาไปคนละแบบคนไข้ก็เสียชีวิตอันนี้มันเป็น error ที่เกิดขึ้นถามว่ามันเกิดได้ยังไงเพราะมันก็เกิดได้อะเกิดได้แต่ถามว่าแล้วเราจะแก้ไขเหตุการณ์ครั้งต่อไปอย่างไรจริงๆเนี่ยเหตุการณ์ต่างๆเหล่านี้เนี่ยเป็นของที่เราเจอได้เรื่อยๆนะแต่เราก็ไม่อยากเจอนะครับแต่ถามว่าเรามามองเป็นประเด็นใหญ่นะเรื่อง patient identification ถ้าเรามองใน accidental model อันนี้เนี่ยจะพบว่ามันเกิดอะไรต่ออะไรเยอะแยะเลยผมอาจจะไม่มีเวลาแต่ทุกคนจะไปโฟกัสที่ไหนตรงนี้ป่ะแถวนี้ป่ะห้องบัตรส่งบัตรผิดมาป่ะแต่จริงๆเป็นแฟกเตอร์ของคนไข้อยู่บางส่วนไหมว่าคนไข้ชื่อที่ซ้ำๆกันแล้วก็เป็นของทีมไหมไม่ได้ตรวจสอบชื่อให้ชัดสะกดให้ชัดถ้าห้องบัตรอาจจะชำนาญมากขึ้นบอกไม่ใช้ภาษาพูดเขียนใส่กระดาษสิใช่ไหมเป็น organization process ซ่อนอยู่หรือเปล่าว่า identification ของคนไข้ OPD card ควรจะมีรูปไหมจริงๆมันซ่อนกันอยู่ในนี้ทำให้มันเกิด error ขึ้นมาอันนี้เป็นลักษณะที่มันเกิดขึ้นประจำเรื่อยๆอันนี้ก็เลยมีหนังสือเล่มหนึ่งออกมาซึ่งเป็นสิ่งที่ปกติเจอได้ทุกมนุษย์เราเป็นสิ่งที่ทำอะไรพลาดได้เรื่อยนะครับ human factors in healthcare คนไทยเราก็พูดกันอยู่เรื่อยๆว่าคนที่ไม่เคยทำอะไรคนที่ไม่เคยผิดพลาดคือคนที่ไม่ทำอะไรอันนี้มันเป็นสิ่งที่เราเกิดขึ้นได้เพียงแต่เราจะยอมรับจริงๆเราก็ไม่อยากให้เกิดนะแต่ถามว่าเกิดได้แล้วเราจะป้องกันครั้งต่อไปได้อย่างไรกรณีอย่างนี้มีเยอะแยะนะครับอันนี้ก็เลยเข้ามาสู่คำว่า non technical skill นะครับ non technical skill develop มาจาก crew resource management นะครับของทางการบินมันคืออะไรนะครับหรือปัจจุบันก็พยายามเปลี่ยนในวงการแพทย์ก็เลยกลายเป็น CRM Crisis Resource Management นะครับมันคืออะไรฟังแล้ว Non Technical Skill เดี๋ยวผมก็จะพูดต่อนะครับจริงๆมันมี2โดเมนซ้อนผสมกันอยู่ก็คือ Cognitive กับ Mental Skill ก็คือเขามีหลายๆมิติแล้วก็ analyze ออกมาว่า4เรื่องเนี่ยเป็นเรื่องที่สำคัญในการ non technical skill ในการดูแลรักษาคนไข้ทำให้คนไข้ปลอดภัยอันที่หนึ่งก็คือ cognitive mental skill ศัพท์นี้ก็ฟังแล้วก็แปลว่าอะไรวะแป แปลว่าขอโทษนะครับแปลว่าอะไรครับเป็นการสร้างภาพเป็น mental skill พอมองปุ๊บเรามองเห็นอะไรตรงนี้สมัยนี้สมัยก่อนอาจจะง่ายสมัยนี้ทุกท่านจะเห็นว่าภาพใน Facebook ขึ้นมา1ช็อตแล้วก็จะมีคอมเมนต์ลงมาเยอะเลยอย่างนี้ไม่ใช่ cognitive ไม่ mental skill เพราะว่าเรายังไม่รู้ที่มาที่ไปเลยมีภาพสมมติผมนั่งอย่างเงี้ยแล้วมาถ่ายรูปแชะผมตอนกำลังหลับตาพอดีแล้วก็โพสต์เข้าไปทุกคนจะบอกว่าอะไรอ๋ออาจารย์นั่งหลับแต่จริงๆอาจจะไม่ใช่ก็ได้อันนี้มันเป็นมันไม่ได้สร้างภาพอันนี้แชะ snapshot เพราะฉะนั้นการรักษาคนไข้ในปัจจุบันเราจะเห็นว่าทุกโมดด้านเนี้ยลดลงทุกคนจะ snapshot หมดเลยสูตร BP ตกสูตร BP ขึ้นสูตร breathing สูตรอะไรทำให้วิธีการคิดง่ายแต่ไม่ได้ฟอร์มมาตั้งแต่ต้น original มาจากอะไรอันนี้เป็นส่วนหนึ่งอีกส่วนหนึ่งคือ interpersonal skill หรือ social skill เป็นการดีลกับทีมก็จะไปโฟกัสในทีมเวิร์กการสื่อสารระหว่างทีมแล้วก็การบริหารจัดการทีมอันนี้จะเป็นโฟกัสของ non-technical skill ผมย้อนกลับมาที่ผมกล่าวเมื่อกี้อันนี้ผมก็แคปเจอร์รูปมาจาก Facebook แล้วถามว่าคนเห็นอะไรคนเห็นด้านตรงหรือคนเห็นด้านข้างก็มันเห็นครึ่งนึงอ่ะก็ไม่มีใครตอบได้ว่านี่เป็นด้านตรงหรือด้านข้างแต่คนเราก็จะแปลละคนส่วนหนึ่งก็จะบอกด้านตรงคนส่วนหนึ่งก็แปลว่าด้านข้างตรงนี้ไม่สำคัญแต่ว่าถ้าเราเห็นด้านข้างแล้วแอสซูว่าเรามองคิดว่าเป็นด้านตรงแล้วเราทรีตไปแบบคนไข้เป็นด้านข้างนั่นก็ไปแล้วเพราะฉะนั้นมันไม่ได้สร้างภาพขึ้นมาอันนี้เป็นสิ่งที่เราเกิดขึ้นอันนี้เป็นธรรมชาติของมนุษย์ครับมนุษย์ก็ไม่ได้เห็นทั้งหมดแต่ว่าสร้างภาพที่ตัวเองเชื่อขึ้นมาอาจารย์ลื่นเริงนั่งหลับประจำเพราะฉะนั้นภาพตอนนี้หลับตาอันนี้เป็นประสบการณ์เก่าเอามาสร้างกันขึ้นมาทำให้เกิดอ๋อไอ้นี่นั่งหลับอีกแล้วเรซิเดนต์คนหนึ่งมาสายประจำครั้งนั้นเช้าวันนั้นเขาอาจจะท้องเสียรถชนแต่พอมาสายปุ๊บสิ่งที่อินเตอร์พีทมาคือคนที่ขี้เกียจอันนี้เป็นลักษณะแบบนั้นคืออันนี้แหละเราเรียกว่าเป็นธรรมชาติของมนุษย์นะเป็น cognitive skill นะคนเรารับภาพแล้วก็จะสร้างภาพแล้วก็คิดเอาเองให้ฟิตกับที่เราคิดเอาไว้เพราะฉะนั้นผมพูดตรงนี้เนี่ยเรากำลังจะพูดถึงโฟกัส on non-technical skill เรามองถึงการ training process ของบุคลากรทางการแพทย์ทั้งพยาบาลทั้งหมอทั้งอะไร ก็แล้วแต่เราสอนอะไรกันบ้างเวลาในหลักสูตรความรู้ใช่ไหมสอน experience ใช่ไหมสอนทำนู่นทำนี่ทำหัตถการต่างๆใช่ไหมใส่โฟเล่ใส่ทิวใส่โน่นนี่นั่นแล้วก็เทรนออกมาแล้วก็ส่งคนคนเนี้ยกลุ่มนี้ออกไปทำงานกับคนไข้ทำอะไรต่ออะไรที่มันคอมเพล็กซ์ยากมากขึ้นเรื่อยๆแต่สิ่งที่เราขาดส่วนหนึ่งก็คือสมมุติเราพูดในห้องผ่าตัดนะครับบรรยากาศในห้องผ่าตัดเป็นอย่างไรดินามิกเปลี่ยนแปลงอย่างรวดเร็วมีเพรสเชอร์จากเวลาเอาเร็วๆๆๆๆๆผมจะผ่าแล้วเอาเร็วๆๆๆเอาคนไข้เข้าเดี๋ยวนี้อะไรอย่างเงี้ยทำใหมีความเครียดเกิดขึ้นไหมเร่งด้วยเวลาทำให้กระบวนการไม่คอมพลีทไหมเครียดคอมเพล็กซ์อยู่ๆก็บลีดขึ้นมาอยู่ๆคนไข้มา20คนแล้วก็ส่งเข้าไปอย่างกรณีที่เราเห็นบ่อยๆแมสคาชูตี้มั่วกันหมดเลยผิดคนของเราก็เจอครับของผมก็เจอของสรรพนามนี้ไม่ถูกที่โรงพยาบาลที่บางสถาบันก็จะเจออันนี้แหละสิ่งที่เราไอ้ non-technical skill จะมาเติมเต็มในสิ่งต่างๆเหล่านี้ทำให้การดูแลคนไข้เรา complete มากขึ้นเรามีความรู้เรามี technical skill สอนทำหัตถการต่างๆแต่ non-technical skill เราสอนเราสอนกันอยู่จริงๆมันสอนเป็นแบบ informal นะสอนกันอยู่แต่ว่ามันไม่ได้หยิบออกมาเป็น formal ที่ชัดเจนเอ้ยเคสนี้ดูไม่ค่อยดีนะดู bleed นะเห็นหมอคนนี้เดินเข้ามาหรือหมอดมยาคนนี้เดินเข้ามาเฮ้ยวันนี้จะจบเคสไหมเนี่ยหรือว่าถ้าเห็นคนนี้เดินเข้ามาโอ้โล่งอกอันนี้มันเป็นถ้าสมัยก่อนเราก็บอกว่าซิกเซนแต่จริงๆไม่ใช่ซิกเซนหรอกมันเป็นการสร้างภาพขึ้นมาเป็นซิทูเอชั่นอะแวร์เนสเราเห็นแล้วแต่ว่าเดี๋ยวผมจะพูดต่อนะครับเพราะฉะนั้นผมกำลังพูดถึงเมนทัลสกิลหรือ cognitive skill ในด้าน situation awareness ประโยคที่ต่างๆเหล่านี้ก็คือ situation awareness awareness ก็คือความตระหนักใช่ไหม situation คือเห็นสถานการณ์แล้วเรารู้ว่ามันคืออะไรอันนี้แหละเป็น non technical skill ที่จะเกิดขึ้นผมเพราะฉะนั้นผมขออนุญาตสรุปเข้าสู่ว่า non technical skill focus ตรงส่วนไหนเราดูการรักษาคนไข้นะสลับซับซ้อนมากนะเริ่มตั้งแต่หมอ1คนพยาบาล1คนบุคลากรทุกส่วนสอดประสานกันอย่างเรียกว่าณปัจจุบันเรียกว่ากลมกลืนตั้งแต่คนเข็นยกคนเข็นคนไข้เข้า OR เอาคนไข้ขึ้นเตียงติดมอนิเตอร์เอาคนไข้ออกย้ายออกเข็นเข้าทุกอย่างเนี่ยแต่ว่าแต่ละคนก็มีความผิดพลาดเกิดขึ้นได้นะครับอันนี้เป็นอินดิวิดวลแล้วก็เข้าสู่กระบวนการทีมแล้วเข้าสู่องค์กรแล้วเข้าสู่ระบบสาธารณสุขสลับซับซ้อนมากแต่ละส่วนก็จะมีช่องโหว่ของแต่ละส่วนแล้วทำให้ถ้าคนที่เข้าไปทำงานแล้วก็มองไม่เห็นช่องโหว่นั้นแล้วแต่ละคนปล่อยหลุดช่องโหว่ออกไปที่ทุกท่านก็คงจะเข้าใจสวิตช์ชีสโมเดลอะหลุดออกไปในที่สุดจะเกิดเออร์เลอร์แต่สิ่งที่เราโฟกัสลงไปคนสุดท้ายที่หลุดปล่อยให้หลุดนั่นก็คือคนใช่ไหมก็ไปโฟกัสตรง human error บอกว่าคนนี้ผิดคนนี้ทำไม่ดีแต่จริงๆไม่ใช่หรอกทุกอย่างมันไหลคาสเคดลงมาเรื่อยๆจนทำให้เกิด error เกิดขึ้นฉะนั้นผมว่าประเด็นเริ่มต้นเนี่ยต้องมี awareness ก่อน situation awareness เนี่ยจะต้องให้ทุกคนรู้ก่อนว่าเฮ้ยมันมีโอกาสนะแต่กระบวนการทำให้รู้ได้อย่างไรนี่เดี๋ยวเราต้องคุยกันต่อนะว่ายาวเลยว่าทำไมบางคนมองเห็นทำไมบางคนมองไม่เห็นมันก็คือเป็น cognitive skill ที่คนเราสร้างภาพเห็นหรือเปล่าแล้วทำไมบางคนไม่เห็นยกตัวอย่างอันนี้เป็นตัวอย่างที่ผมแคปเจอร์มาจากในหนังสือยาแอนเซปบ้านเราไม่ได้เป็นพิกเจอร์แบบนี้แอนเซปก็คือเซฟาโซลินเป็นแอนติไบโอติกกับเวคิวโรเนียมก็คือมัสเซอร์รีแล็กแซนต์สองอย่างนี้มาอยู่ด้วยกันแล้วก็ฉีดผิดคนไข้ก็หยุดหายใจถ้าคนไม่มี situation awareness โอ้ไม่ผิดหรอกอาจารย์เนี่ยอย่าเอามาไว้ด้วยกันได้ไม่เป็นไรเห็นไหมอาจารย์เนี่ยขวดก็คนละไซส์ฉลากก็คนละสีแต่ถ้าคนมี awareness อีกแบบนึงก็บอกเฮ้ยไม่ได้อย่างนี้อันตรายเขาบอกถ้าเกิดสีแดง flip off ก็ยิ่งเหมือนกันเข้าใหญ่นะแล้วก็ฉีดแล้วมันเป็นยาที่มันอยู่บนโต๊ะดมยาเหมือนกันเวลาเราดมยาเราต้องใช้ทั้งสองอย่างอย่างนี้ถ้าคนเห็นแล้วแยกแล้ว alert อย่างนี้เราก็เรียกว่า situation awareness มี awareness จริงๆไอ้พวกอย่างนี้มาตรฐานเขากำหนดไว้อยู่แล้วถ้าใครเคยได้ทำเกี่ยวกับด้านมาตรฐานเขาจะมีทางเภสัชกรรมเขาก็จะเรียกว่าลาซาลูกอะไรซาวอะไรยาคล้ายๆกันต้องแยกต้องมี signal ให้ alert แต่ตรงนี้เนี่ยมันยากนะคนที่จะมองยกอันนี้เกิดไม่นานจริงๆอันเนี้ยเกิดในต่างประเทศมามากมายแล้วเขาก็ alert กันมามากมายก็คือเอสเมอรอนหรือร็อกโคโรเนียมเป็นยาหย่อนกล้ามเนื้อที่เราใช้อีกอันนึงก็คือเอสโมลอลเบต้าบล็อกเกอร์สถาบันนี้คงไม่เกิดเพราะว่าสถาบันนี้ผมคิดว่าตัวบนไม่มีตัวล่างไม่มั่นใจว่าเข้ามาหรือยังแต่ที่จุฬาเนี่ยมาแล้วพอเข้ามาแล้วก็เกิดตาม repeated ตามที่เขา report เลยก็คือใน ICU จะฉีดเอสโมลอลเข้าไปเบต้าบล็อกเกอร์เพราะคนไข้ heart rate เร็วก็ขียา ESM ก็ขึ้นมาปุ๊บปุ๊บคนคลิกถัดไปก็คลิกเลยไม่รู้ตัวไหนขึ้นก็คลิกแทนที่จะได้เอสโมลอลก็เข้ามาสู่เอสเมอรอนก็ได้มาเพราะฉะนั้นถามว่า error มันอยู่ที่ไหนอ๋อ human error แต่ถามจริงๆมันเป็นที่ระบบของมันไหมระบบจริงๆระบบดีไซน์ไว้เยอะแล้วนะเอสเมอรอนปกติจะไม่จ่ายที่วอร์ดทั่วไปจะไม่จ่ายออกเอสโมลอลทั่วไปก็ไม่จ่ายออกแต่คนคีย์เป็นวิสัญญีเภสัชเห็นก็จ่ายออกคำถามถัดมาปกติเขาก็จะไม่จ่ายไปทั่วไปในวอร์ดนี่เป็น ICU ก็จ่ายออกมาจ่ายออกมาพยาบาลรับพยาบาลก็เห็น ESM ก็ตามคีย์เลยนะใบปริ้นออกมาเป็นเอสเมอรอนเขาก็ให้เอสเมอรอนก็ฉีดเข้าไปคนไข้ก็หยุดหายใจถามว่าพยาบาลพลาดไหมก็คงกำกึ่งๆนะเพราะว่าเวลา พริ้นออกมามันก็เอสเมอรอนแต่ถามว่าเวลาฉีดเนี่ยต้องดูไหมจริงๆเรานอนเทคนิคอลสกิลไม่ควรจะไปโฟกัสเนี่ยพยาบาลผิดหมอผิดตรงนี้ไม่ใช่ตรงนี้มันเป็นช่องโหว่ของระบบแล้วทำให้แต่ละคนคนละนิดคนละหน่อยแล้วปุ๊บปุ๊บปุ๊บปุ๊บปุ๊บขึ้นมาแล้วทุกคนก็พร้อมพยายามบอกว่าดีไอทีจะต้องดีไซน์อะไรต่ออะไรขึ้นมาเพื่อการฮิวแมนเออร์เรอร์ยังไงก็ตามก็ยังจะมีไอทีก็จะมีช่องโหว่ของไอทีแต่ผมอาจจะไม่มีเวลาคุยในตอนนี้เพียงแต่ว่าลักษณะแบบนี้เราเรียกว่าซิทูเอชันอะเวเนสมองเห็นไหมคนที่จะสั่งยาเห็นไหมคนที่จะเอายาเข้าเห็นไหมเภสัชกรรมเวลาจะเอายาสองอย่างที่มันคล้ายๆกันแบบนี้เข้ามาในห้องยาเนี้ยพิจารณาไหมว่าเอ๊ะเราจะเอาเข้ามาไหมหรือจะเปลี่ยนยี่ห้อบริษัทอันนี้หรือจะแยกอย่างไรอันนี้แหละเป็น awareness ที่เกิดขึ้นงั้นผมก็คนเราได้ information แล้วจะได้รับความสนใจไหมจะคิดไหมจะวิเคราะห์ไหมอันนี้ก็เป็นลักษณะของ situation awareness แหละมันมีหลายระดับระดับที่หนึ่ง perception ก็คือฟังแล้วเข้าใจแล้วก็พยากรณ์ไปข้างหน้ายกตัวอย่างอันนี้ผมสรุปสับอันนี้ก็อาจจะยากอาจจะฟังแล้วอยู่บนเมฆนะมีคนบอกว่าอาจารย์เลคเชอร์อะไรไม่รู้เป็นนามธรรมมากเลยเป็นเมตาคอกนิชันฟังเอ๊ะมันแปลว่าอะไรนะเมตาแปลว่าอภิยิ่งใหญ่เหนือจากคอกนิชันธรรมดาจะต้องมีการวิเคราะห์แล้วโปรเจกต์ไปข้างหน้ายกตัวอย่างไม่ต้องอ่านนะครับเพียงแต่ว่าถ้าเราเห็น OR file เรายังไม่เคยเจอนะแล้วแต่ถามว่าถ้าเราเห็นรีพอร์ตแบบนี้ปื๊ดเดียวอ่านแล้วเฮ้ยแล้วของเราล่ะเราทำแบบนี้เปล่าแล้วเราจะป้องกันครั้งต่อไปอย่างไรแล้วครั้งถ้าเกิดไฟล์ใน OR แล้วเราจะทำอย่างไรอันนี้อะไรอย่างเงี้ยเราเรียกว่าเรามี situation awareness ผมก็ยังนึกไม่ออกนะสมมุติว่าระหว่าง on bypass แล้วต้อง evacuate คนไข้นี้ก็ยังนึกไม่ออกเลยว่าจะไปได้ยังไงบางอย่างแก้ไม่ได้ก็คงถ้าไปแก้ตอนสุดท้ายไม่ได้ก็ต้องวางระบบป้องกันอย่างดีเป็น risk reduction ไปแทนที่จะเป็นหรือ risk modification ไปอันนี้ของเราก็ทันสมัย epidural block ใส่สายใส่ยา infusion แล้วก็ใส่สายเข้าไปแล้วก็ dripก็เกิดเรื่อยๆเกิดประจำสปอริดิกเอามาเคนพอหลุดเลิศคนต่อผิดก็เอามาเคนเนี้ยไปต่อเข้า IV drip เป็นของที่เจอได้เรื่อยๆของที่ผมเจอก็ทันสมัยก็ตามเนี้ยถามว่ามันถ้าเราเห็นรีพอร์ตแบบนี้เราจะทำอย่างไรให้ไม่ให้เกิดหรือให้เกิดน้อยที่สุดอันนี้เราก็เรียกว่าเป็น situation awareness เช่นโอ้ต้องมี color code ไหมอย่างทางสรพ.ก็กำหนดนะละ simple เคยได้ยินไหม save เดี๋ยวโทษ L เนี่ยก็คือ line เพราะฉะนั้นการ label line ให้มันสีต่างกันไหมแต่ถ้าคนมี awareness ขึ้นไปการ design ระบบ extension กับ epidural จะต้องเป็นอีกระบบหนึ่งเพื่อกัน IV injection ตอนนี้ก็กำลังจะมีละสาย epidural และหัวต่อที่ใช้ saline ธรรมดากับ extension ธรรมดาต่อไม่ได้อันนี้แหละเป็น situation awareness กันเอาไว้ไม่ให้เกิดเลยเป็นแก้ตั้งแต่ system สมัยก่อน 50ปีที่แล้วท่านอาจารย์ของผมเองก็พูดเรื่อยๆว่าแก๊สผิดแก๊สสลับคือถ้าบอกว่ายิ่งเวนติเลตยิ่งเวนติเลตแล้วยิ่งเขียวให้เปิดไนตรัส50กับออกซิเจน50ถ้าให้ 100% แล้วเขียวแสดงว่ามันสลับออกมาจากไปลายอันนั้นเป็น awareness ของอาจารย์สมัยนี้มันไม่เจอแล้วล่ะเพราะว่ามี safety system แท้งต่อไม่ได้อะไรต่ออะไรเดี๋ยวนี้เขาอันนี้แหละเป็นการดีไซน์ระบบที่กันแต่ถ้าแก๊สผิดมาจากโรงงานอันนั้นก็อีกเรื่องนึงนั่นเราก็มี system ที่บล็อกเอาไว้ก็คือ FiO2 monitor ใช่ไหมแต่ถ้าเราเห็นแล้วเดี๋ยวผมจะเล่าต่อถ้ามีเวลาอันนี้แหละเป็น situation awareness ถ้าเรามี awareness เราก็จะตัดสินใจ decision making ได้ทีนี้กระบวนการตัดสินใจก็อาจจะไม่เหมือนกับตัดสินใจเอ๊ะอย่างนี้ควรจะอย่างนี้นี่แต่บางครั้งมันไม่ใช่นะอันนี้เดี๋ยวผมจะให้รูปอันนี้ให้ดูทุกมีใครเคยไปเที่ยวไหมครับน่าเที่ยวเนาะถ้าก็มีหลายๆแบบแล้วแต่คิดอันนี้ต้องอันนี้ไม่ได้กล่าวจะว่าหรือตำหนิหรืออะไรนะครับบางคนก็บอกว่าเออน่าเที่ยวแปลกดีบางคนบอกเฮ้ยอันตรายก็ถ้าคนแถวนี้ไม่อันตรายถูกไหม ในวัฒนธรรมหนึ่งไม่อันตรายชาวบ้านรู้แต่ถ้าคนไม่ทำตามโปรซีเจอร์ที่กำหนดไว้เป๊ะเป๊ะเป๊ะเป๊ะจะเกิดอันตรายขึ้นมาถึงต้องหุบล่มต้องปื้นปื้นเห็นอะไรต่ออะไรเนี่ยอย่างนั้นน่ะมันก็เกิดจริงๆเกิดจริงๆนี่ปีใหม่ปี57ผมเห็นข่าวผมมันก็น่าก็เกิดได้นะของปกติอันนี้แหละถามว่ามันมีอักซิเดนต์มีอะไรเกิดขึ้นมีเลเทนเฟเลียซ่อนอยู่ไหมรางรถไฟกับไอ้อย่างเงี้ยมันควรจะมีมาตรฐานห่างเท่าไหร่แล้วคนควรจะเท่าไหร่ก่อนจะรถไฟมาจะต้องมีโปรซีเจอร์ไหมว่ากั้นเท่าไหร่แต่เคสนี้นี่เป็นลักษณะพิเศษทุกคนมั่นใจว่ารู้แต่จะมีคนไม่รู้เพราะฉะนั้นถ้าเราจะบอกว่ามี non technical skill นะจะต้องมี standard operating procedure ว่าถ้ารถไฟเป็นแบบนี้เนี่ยกันเอาไว้เนี่ยแล้วคนที่จะเข้าไปจะต้อง1ผ่านกระบวนการเทรนนิ่ง2เมื่อได้ยินกระบวนการเทรนนิ่งบอกว่าเมื่อได้ยินรถไฟปุ้นจะต้องหุบล่มหุบเก็บของนะเดินห่างเข้ามาแล้วห้ามยื่นเด็ดขาดอะไรอย่างเงี้ยเราเรียกว่ามีการเทรนนิ่งสำหรับ non technical skill ใน high risk แบบนี้มอเตอร์ไซค์ไอ้โทษปั่นจักรยานก็เหมือนกันมีเนื่องจากเราไม่ได้ดีไซน์ระบบไว้ใช่มั้ยและ standard operating procedure ของการปั่นจักรยานบนท้องถนนในสถานที่ที่ยังไม่ได้ดีไซน์ไว้เต็มที่แบบบ้านเราจะต้องผ่านกระบวนการก่อนใช่ไหมรถจะต้องผ่านกับคนขับรถก็จะต้องผ่านกระบวนการก่อนใช่ไหมในการเทรนนิ่งอันนี้เพื่อป้องกันแต่ตรงนี้ไม่ได้มี non technical skill ถึงเกิดขึ้นทีนี้ก็มีศัพท์คำหนึ่งศัพท์คำนี้ก็เก๋นะครับ normalization of deviance อะไรที่เบี่ยงเบนไปอ่ะถือว่าทำไปนานๆก็กลายเป็นปกตินะพฤติกรรมที่เบี่ยงเบนเนี่ยไม่คิดว่าเบี่ยงเบนแล้วก็ถือว่าเป็นปกติเคยเห็นมอเตอร์ไซค์ไหมครับมีเส้นขีดใช่ไหมว่าไม่ให้จอดคันที่1ก็เลยไปนิดนึงคันที่2ก็เลยอีกในที่สุดก็เลยขั้นที่รถเลี้ยวมาก็ชนอย่างนั้นเนี่ยเลยเรียกว่า normalization of deviance เอ้ยไม่เป็นไรหรอกไม่เป็นไรหรอกโอ้ผมทำได้ก็จะมีกลุ่มนึงอันนี้ต้องระวังซึ่งเราก็เห็นกันบ่อยๆบางครั้งผมก็ทำเฮ้ยไม่ต้องทำตามกฎหรอกผมทำงี้มา30ปีคุณหยุดเดี๋ยวนี้เลยฟังผมแล้วก็ทำตามที่ผมบอกอาจารย์บีดมากก็เอาเลือดมาอาจารย์บอกว่าเอาให้คนไข้เดี๋ยวอาจารย์ยังไม่ได้เช็คเลยเดี๋ยวรอคอนเฟิร์มกับบัตรแบงก์ก่อนไม่ได้คนไข้จะตายแล้วเอาเข้าไปเลยอย่างเงี้ยแล้วเสร็จแล้วเรสซิเดนต์ผู้การเทรนนิ่งในยิ่งในเทรนนิ่งอินสติทูตคนก็ค่อยๆให้ไปเลยหวังว่าห้องเลือดจะเช็คมาแล้วหวังว่าห้องผ่าตัดจะเช็คมาแล้วหวังว่าคนหยิบจะเช็คมาแล้วพอรัวขึ้นมาก็จบอันนี้ก็เป็นลักษณะที่เห็นเวลาดมยาก็จะมีถาดยามาอันนึงก็เขามาตรฐานกำหนดว่ายาต้องแยกยาแต่ละกลุ่มต้องแยกดีแลกซันต้องแยกยาเวโซเพรสเซอร์ต้องแยกเกิดอะไรขึ้นพออย่างนี้ก็เอาอีกหน่อยนะอาจารย์สะดวกดีมาทีละอย่างผมมาเห็นอีกทีนึงในถาดยาที่อาจารย์ดมยามีอะไรบ้างเนี่ยเอสเมอรอนยาหย่อนกล้ามเนื้อดีโวเฟตเวโซเพรสเซอร์ซักซินิลโคลีนเฮปารินพรีซีเด็กเนี่ยเหมือนไหมไม่เหมือนอาจารย์ฝามันลายไม่เหมือนก็ไม่เหมือนรีโวเฟตล่ะอันนี้กับอันนี้ล่ะโอ้ยไม่เหมือนหรอกอาจารย์แต่ผมเคยเห็นเรสซิเดนต์คว้าโปรซิกมีนสมัยก่อนเป็นขวดกับเฮปารินเนี่ยนะฉีกดูดออกมานะนั่นหมายความว่ามันมีกระบวนการป้องกันอยู่แต่เราเกิดสับนี้ขึ้นมาเออไม่เป็นไรแล้วทุกคนก็เออสะดวกดีไปเรื่อยๆไปเรื่อยๆในที่สุดก็ก้าวข้ามเรนจ์ที่เรากำหนดเอาไว้คนที่ก้าวข้ามเนี่ยก็แสดงว่า situation awareness ไม่ดีพอผมจะกล่าวถึงอีกคำหนึ่งเดี๋ยวผมต้องรีบแล้วกระบวนการตัดสินใจมันไม่ใช่มนุษย์นะไม่ใช่มีอย่างนี้แล้วมาอย่างนี้บางวันเนี่ยเห็นหน้าคนนี้แล้วอารมณ์ไม่ดีมี emotion เข้ามาเกี่ยวข้องกระบวนการตัดสินใจก็เปลี่ยนไปนะคนคนหนึ่งทำเหตุการณ์เดียวกันบุคคลที่สามมารีแอคไม่เหมือนกันไม่เหมือนกันสมมุติผมเป็นอาจารย์เรสซิเดนต์คนหนึ่งโกรธมากทำอะไรผิดก็ไม่ว่าแต่ในขณะเดียวกันในเหตุการณ์เดียวกันเรสซิเดนต์อีกคนหนึ่งทำอาจจะรีแอคไม่เหมือนกันเพราะว่าไม่ใช่ A 1 บวก 1 เป็น 2จะมีอีโมชันมีวันนี้อารมณ์ไม่ดีไว้รถติดไว้วันนี้ร้อนว่ะโอ้วันนี้หงุดหงิด มันก็ react ออกมาไม่เหมือนกันนี่เป็นกระบวนการตัดสินใจของมนุษย์ซึ่งมันอาจจะเบี่ยงเบนไปได้นี่คือมนุษย์เพราะฉะนั้นมันเกิด error ได้ตลอดเวลาเพราะฉะนั้นมนุษย์เนี่ยการตัดสินใจเนี่ยไม่ใช่ rational อย่างเดียวมี psychoไม่ใช่ลอจิกอย่างเดียวไม่ใช่เหตุผลอย่างเดียวมันมีอย่างอื่นเข้ามาซ่อนอันนี้ก็ทำให้
You have 3 minutes left
ครับขอบคุณครับอันนี้ก็เป็นกระบวนการของ situation awareness อันนี้ก็เป็น error ที่เกิดขึ้นผมกำลังจะรีบแล้วอันนี้อีกอันนึงก็คือผมพูดถึงมนุษย์แล้วมนุษย์คน interact กับทีมก็เป็น interpersonal skill จะมีหลายๆมิติที่เราร่วมกันเวลาสื่อสารออกมาเนี่ยพอคำพูดออกไปเนี่ยโอ้สมมุติว่าresident ทำอะไรผิดอย่างหนึ่งผมบอกว่าโอ้ยผมอยากตายแต่ว่าผมอยากตายจริงไหมอาจารย์ขามีดค่ะอยากตายจริงไหมไม่ใช่นะมันมีอะไรซ่อนอยู่นะเพราะงั้นสิ่งที่สื่อออกไปความหมายอาจจะคนละแบบนะคนรับก็อาจจะเข้าใจคนละแบบนะเสียงบางครั้งดีมากดีมากมันไม่เหมือนกันนะคอนเทนต์เหมือนกันนะเพราะฉะนั้นอันนี้การสื่อสารเพราะฉะนั้นไอ้ non technical skill เวลาสื่อสารพูดอะไรจะต้องเป็นไปตามนั้นอ่ะออกไปเลยออกไปจากห้องนี้คุณต้องการให้ออกไปจากห้องนี้จริงๆไหมหรือว่าคุณต้องการให้คนที่ฟังเนี่ยทำให้มันดีขึ้นหน่อยตั้งใจหน่อยอันนี้แหละในกระบวนการสื่อสารถ้า non technical skill เพื่อ position safety พูดอะไรต้องแปลอย่างนั้นประชดประชันหรือพูดตรงข้ามเนี่ยไม่เอานะครับแล้วก็ close loop อันนี้เดี๋ยวผมจะไปเร็วๆ team communication อันนี้สิ่งที่เห็นนะอันนี้ชัดเจนอันนี้เป็นกระบวนการสื่อสารในทีมที่ผมเห็นที่ในห้องผ่าตัดที่นี่ลด flow จะเจนบอกจากแคมป์เอลตาลด flow ประโยคถัดมา perfectionist จะตอบว่าอะไร flow 0ใช่ไหมครับแปลว่าอะไรทำไมคำว่าการสื่อสารของเซอร์เจียนคำว่าลดโฟลว์นี่เพื่ออะไรเพื่อไม่ให้เพเชอร์สูงใช่ไหมเพราะฉะนั้นคลอสลูปถ้าเกิดไม่มีการคลอสลูปเขาเรียกอะไรคลอสลูปอะรีพีทคำสั่งไอ้อย่างนั้นแหละก็จะเกิดเรื่องแล้วรีพีทคำสั่งลดโฟลว์ถ้าสมมติคนทั่วไปไม่รู้ก็ลดโฟลว์รถจริงเปล่าไม่รู้บางทีก็มันต้องมีแปรต่อจะต้องหมุนนะแล้วดมยาจะต้องว่าไงดูพิเชอร์ป่ะอันนี้เป็นลักษณะของทีมคอมมิวนิเคชันที่เห็นที่สถาบันแห่งนี้เทรนเป็นแบบอินฟอร์มอลคือมันเป็นรูทีนไปแล้วทุกคนบอกโอ้ยอย่างนี้ไม่เห็นมีอะไรแต่ไม่เห็นที่อื่นเป็นลักษณะที่ลักษณะ non technical skill จริงๆมีมานานแล้วล่ะเพียงแต่เราไม่ได้หยิบขึ้นมาให้มันเป็นดูขลังแคลมออนปั๊มว่าไงแบ็กอัพอะตรงยาก็แคลมออนก็ต่อกันไปยกตัวอย่างอันนี้เป็นสิ่งที่เกิดขึ้นจริง ENT surgeon ยิงเลเซอร์ในแอร์เวย์แล้วก็เกิดไฟเป็นแบบเนี้ยที่นี่อาจจะไม่ได้ยิงเลเซอร์แต่กระบวนการแบบนี้จะเกิดขึ้นได้เวลาทำเทเคียโอสโตมีอ่ะเปิดเทเคียแล้ว 100% ออกซิเจนถามว่ากระบวนการสื่อสารในเคสนี้ผิดอย่างไรเซอร์เจนบอกจะยิงเลเซอร์แล้วควรจะทำยังไงดมยาก็โอเคยิงครับได้เลยครับอาจารย์ผมพร้อมแต่แค่นี้ไม่พอมันจะต้องแปลว่าก่อนจะยิงเลเซอร์จะต้องมี SOP ขึ้นมาลด FiO2 ลงเหลือแอร์ตึงๆๆๆถึงจะส่งสัญญาณว่ายิงเลเซอร์ได้แต่ว่าอันนั้นบอกยิงเลยครับอาจารย์ยิงเลยแต่สัญญาณไม่ผ่านแล้วเซอร์คูลเลตล่ะสครับล่ะอ๋อยิงเครื่องมือพร้อมไม่ใช่แค่นั้นอันนี้คอมเพล็กซ์มากกว่านั้นก็คือเราจะต้องรู้ว่าเนี่ยจะเกิดไฟขึ้นเพราะฉะนั้นอุปกรณ์การดับไฟจะต้องเกิดเซอร์คูลเลตจะต้องรู้ว่าถ้าแอร์เวย์ไฟแล้วจะทำอย่างไรนี่เป็นกระบวนการสื่อสารแล้ว non technical skill ที่ซ่อนอยู่เคสนี้สิ่งที่เกิดขึ้นก็คือเคสนี้ไม่ได้เกิดแบบนั้นยิงพอเราวิเคราะห์ลงไปจริงๆเราจะรู้ว่าเคสนี้พยาบาลก็บอกเครื่องมือหนูก็เช็คว่าเครื่องมือพร้อมหรือเปล่าไอ้อย่างนี้ไม่พอละอย่างนี้ไม่พอแล้วเราจะต้อง situation awareness มองลงไปว่ามันจะเกิดอะไรต่ออาจจะเกิดไฟได้น้ำพร้อมไหมเลเซอร์พร้อมไหมทีมพร้อมไหมว่าจะถ้าเกิด airway ไฟจะทำอย่างไรเพราะฉะนั้นการ confirm ว่า พร้อมยิงเลเซอร์แค่นั้นไม่พอเขาคงจะต้องคอนเฟิร์มต่อว่าผมลด FiO2 แล้วนะตึ้งตึ้งตึ้งตึ้งแต่ถ้าซ่อนไว้ในใจหวังว่าคนเขาจะรู้เองเนี่ยมันบางครั้งมันจะพลาดอันนี้เป็นลักษณะของทีมคอมมิวนิเคชันอันนี้เราก็เคยเจอนะครับเจาะคอในคริสิสอันนี้สำคัญว่าทีมคอมมิวนิเคชันอย่าขึ้นเสียงนะคำสั่งต้องชัดนะอย่าพูดลอยๆนะใครก็ได้ไปเอาดีฟิบริลเลเตอร์มาอย่างเงี้ยไม่ได้คุณไม่งั้นก็เดี๋ยวไปดีฟิบริลเลเตอร์วิ่งไป5คนแล้วในห้องไม่มีคนอย่างนี้ไม่ได้นะครับแล้วก็เขาเรียกว่าฟังจริงๆอันนี้ก็ง่ายๆแหละอันนี้เป็นลักษณะของทีมผมพูดถึงต่อลีดเดอร์ชิพนะครับกับลีดเดอร์นะครับก็คงจะเป็นลักษณะเนี้ยครับ
You have to conclude your talk please
โอเคครับนะครับก็คงจะตอบแค่นี้ว่า non technical skill เนี่ยจะมีบทบาทใน patient safety แล้วก็ crisis จะแต่ละอย่างจะมีบทบาทต่างกันนะครับแล้วก็เป็นการเทรนได้เป็น safety skill อย่าให้รู้ว่าคิดเอาเองนี้ไม่เอาก็ future trend ก็คงจะต้องจาก anesthesia ไป healthcare setting เช่น surgeon นะครับพยาบาลห้องผ่าตัดแล้วก็ circulate อันนี้คงจะต้องเป็น team training นะครับอันนี้ก็ให้ดูว่าของ surgeon ก็มีนะครับครับขอบคุณครับ
Because of the limitation of time, so I think that we have no time for the question. I would like to, for the next topic, please.
Thank you, Dr. Rin Reng, Lilan Krom. After that interesting topic, we have four main topics on this morning. The moderator will be Dr. Chakapan Champathe and Dr. Om Jai Ratananon. Thank you.
Hello.Hello. Good morning, and we will move on to the next topic. This topic is the presented by the Dr. Chu Sang, and he is the chief of the cardiothoracic surgery at here. And he will present about the bilateral DIMA for CABG. Dr. Chu Sang, please.
Yes, thank you very much. My talk today is bilateral mammary artery for CABG, and I would like to start with this picture, who is the father of modern medicine of Thailand, and he also the father of our present king. He used to write this word. May speak in Thai.ขอให้ถือประโยชน์ส่วนตนเป็นที่สองประโยชน์ของเพื่อนมนุษย์เป็นกิจที่หนึ่งลาภทรัพย์และเกียรติยศจะตกมาสู่ตัวท่านถ้าท่านทรงธรรมแห่งอาชีพได้บริสุทธิ์แต่ผมคิดว่าพวกเราในฐานะบุคลากรทางสาธารณสุขขอให้ยึดเพียงสองบรรทัดบนเพียงพอแล้วส่วนสองบรรทัดล่างจะเป็นรางวัลกลับมาหาเราหรือไม่สุดแท้แต่บุญแต่กรรมแต่ชาติปางก่อนที่เราทำไว้นะครับขอเพียงแต่เรามีความสุขที่ได้ช่วยเหลือคนไข้นะฮะขอบคุณครับ for my talk today it's the content of my is the first thing the history of CABG the second one old fashioned facts and modification of the technique to improve the outcome trend of current conduits role of each conduitAnd finally, that is very important, influence of diabetes to conduit, wound infection, hypertension, development of CABG. Look at this slide. The first one who performed the CABG is this surgeon. He is the Canadian surgeon. He put the rima into the muscle of the anterior. And his name is Arthur Weiberg. That we call Weiberg position. It's look like you put the pipe of water into the sponge. It's not into the vessel of the heart. And the first one who performed CBG in human, maybe I'm not sure exactly this man or this one, because it's similar time. Maybe by Dr. Sabisan or Dr. Favarolo from Cleveland Clinic. What happened to my computer? And you know that after the Second World War, we have the Cold War between Russia and America. And during that period of time, about 60 years ago, in 1955, Russia sent the airspace to the out of the world, and this is the first man who come outside the world. And for the American side, the same year, but later, by Alan Shepard in 1961, and American can overcome the Russia by Apollo 11 in 1969, that the first man who walked on the moon. The same as CBG development, there is some competition between Russia and America. Russia by this man, Kolesov, in 1964, he is the first CBG with Lima. And maybe 2 years later, 2 or 3 years later, American surgeon performed the same technique, CBG, Lima to LED. Saphenous vein cap, that is the first conduit that Sabisan and Favarolo used at period of time during the 1960 period. And up to now, saphenous vein still major conduit. Why? Because when we put the 5 gap to the patient, the first one may be Lima, the second one may be Rima of the right, or radial artery, or gasopipoic artery, but the rest should be from saphenous veins. So saphenous vein still the major conduit that we use to the patient. And 10 to 25% of saphenous vein occurred in the first year. 1 to 2% occurred in each year during the first 5 years. And what about later? We expected that later it should be less. However, after 5 years, the incidence of occlusion increased from 1 to 2% to 4 to 5%. And finally, at 10 years, patency rate of saphenous vein is 50 to 60%. The indication for saphenous vein, I mean that all saphenous vein, not no lip, no arterial conduit, are the emergency case. Reduce life expectancy of the patient, renal failure patient, severe pulmonary insufficiency, impair ejection fraction, and debilitating stroke patient. Look at this slide. Is the compare between internal mammary artery and saphenous vein, the patency different significantly. What about the survival? The survival of the Lima and saphenous vein also different. And look at here, from 1976 up to 2005, the age of the patient from average from 55 to 65, and the age of the patient that older than 70 increased. So we have modification of technique of the saphenous vein. Look at here, it's a long-term patency of sequential. What about sequential? Sequential, that means we put the conduit to the target not only one target but two target or maybe tianosmosis with the only one saphenous vein. And look at the result. The sequential is better than individual saphenous vein. So from this paper, they conclude that at around 6 years, patency of sequential saphenous vein better than individual significantly, statistically. That is the just one center. How about the meta-analysis that debuted in 2011? Similar. And they conclude that sequential is better than individual saphenous vein gap. The technique of conduit, we improve the technique. Normally, we harvest the saphenous vein like this, and we have the modification to do the endovascular harvesting. That nowadays in USA, this technique of harvest 80% of the case. In our center, we have done, I think, that more than 500 cases, but unfortunately, we have to stop. The reason, because the company not import this instrument. I have to modify the technique to skip incision. What about the guideline said of the endovascular? The guideline say that endoscopic vein harvesting should be considered to reduce the incidence of leg wound complication. And I personally agreed with this guideline because we have done about 500 cases, but we have just only one case. The patient has the wound infection, very few cases. And now I modify the technique, not open the whole leg, but skip incision like this. What about influence of diabetes to saphenous vein patency? Look at this paper. Conclude that saphenous vein gap occurred when compared between diabetes and non-diabetes. In diabetes patient, the result worse than non-diabetes. For radial artery, who introduced by Professor Caponte in 1977, and this is a radial artery, this is a saphenous vein. When I take the radial, now I make the incision like here, skip incision. And this paper from James Tartaris, Royal Melbourne, Australia, admin about 4 years, and he found that the target of the radial artery to each part of the heart, LVD, diagonal, RCA, PDA, and he concluded from his study that the base patency of radial artery, the target is LVD, 96% at 4 years. And the worst one is the target is RCA, 83%. This is a meta-analysis from 35 studies. The patient approaching 7,000 cases published in 2010. And look at here, compare between saphenous vein and radial artery. The early, not too different, but the midterm and long term. How long of the midterm? Between 1 to 5 years. Long term, more than 5 years. And he concluded from this meta-analysis that early patency saphenous vein similar to radial artery, but mid-term and long-term, the patency of the radial artery is better than saphenous vein. This is meta-analysis from RCA, RCT, randomized control trial in nearly 2,000 patients, and similar to that meta-analysis, patency at 4 years when compared between radial and saphenous vein, radial artery much better than odd ratio 5 times. How about the sequential radial artery? That I said that sequential saphenous vein better than individual. What about radial artery? This paper compare between sequential and non-sequential, and he conclude that no difference of sequential or non-sequential. It means that we can use radial artery as a sequential. And what about the guideline said to the radial artery? The use, this one is American guideline in 2011. He conclude that the radial artery should be should use for the left side choroid system when the lesion more than 70%. What about the right side? The right side should use radial when the occlusion more than 90%. How about the European side, published in 2014? The use of radial artery is recommended only for the target vessel with high degree stenosis. They not mention about the how severe of the stenosis. Influence of diabetes to the radial patency. This paper just read one center, and he conclude that patency of radial artery was correlated to diabetes, related to gender. So this paper against for diabetes when use radial artery. What about the other paper? Single center also, but volume of the case more than the previous paper in 440 cases. And he conclude from his study that no difference between diabetes and non-diabetes in the radial artery patient. And this is also the compare between the result of the radial artery in the OPPUM case, and he conclude that 1 or 5 year gap patency no difference between diabetes and non-diabetes in arterial cabbage, including the radial artery. So it's quite controversial about the influence of diabetes to the radial patency. We have to look some more paper. And the internal mammary artery, or someone said called internal thoracic artery, that we know that it is the base conduit. Why? Because 10-year patency more than 90%. However, we have some contraindication to use LIMA in the case of emergency, in the left subclavian occlusion, in the high dose of chest wall radiation before, and in the case of osteoporosis patient. And this is the compare between single and bilateral MA. At 10 years, look at here, the bilateral MA is better than single MA in the term of survival and in the term of patency. Bilateral MA is also better than single vessel. And this is the technique that we use in the past, that we take the LIMA from the left and LIMA from the right. We have two choice for the target. We might anastomose the LIMA of the right to the LAD and LIMA of the left to the OM, and another one converse LIMA of the right to the circumflex system and LIMA of the left to the LAD. But this is we call pedicle, because when we harvest the LIMA, we harvest including soft tissue, including internal mammary vein. But now we modify the technique. Look at this paper. Review, meta-analysis review from 13 paper. Bilateral MA offer long-term survival benefit than single one. The thing that we have to concern about the bilateral MA, that in the past we use the technique of pedicle, but and we found that the incident of the bilateral MA when we use pedicle, wound infection is more than modern take just only one vessel. And this paper conclude that when bilateral MA are used, sclerotinized technique appear to reduce the incidence of sternal wound infection when compared to the pedicle technique. What is sclerotinized technique? Look at here. This one is the pedicle that MA together with internal mammary vein and soft tissue. And this one is a sclerotinized technique that we take just solely the internal mammary artery, not include the soft tissue, not include the vein. And for the diabetes patient, the problem is the high incidence of deep sternal wound infection with bilateral MA with the previous technique, with the pedicle technique. So this is the paper, single center, compare between bilateral MA sclerotinized technique and pedicle. And look at here, the sclerotinized technique, the incidence of wound infection when compared to conventional, much different. And the incidence of wound infection for diabetes sclerotinized, similar to non-diabetes, conventional or pedicle. So the technique of sclerotinized should be better. However, this is just only one single center paper. What about meta-analysis? Meta-analysis analyzed from, look at the number, nearly 13,000 diabetic patients, and the conduit nearly 4,000 bilateral MA. So I think that is quite a good paper. Look at the outcome. Deep sternal wound infection for sclerotinized bilateral MA, no different from justly lima of the left side. And the second thing, deep sternal wound infection of pedicle by bilateral MA, more than lima 2 times. Another paper, this paper is randomized study, and I think that is, even though the number is just only 35, but it can explain why bilateral MA sclerotinized better than pedicle. Because after the operation, he performed the sternal perfusion, and he found that when compared sternal perfusion in non-diabetic patient, no difference of sclerotinized or pedicle. But in the diabetic patient, sclerotinized technique better blood perfusion than pedicle, significant, better than how much? Nearly 50% the perfusion better. Patency of the sclerotinized MA. This is a meta-analysis published in 2009. And from this paper, demonstrate both sclerotinized and pedicle have excellent patency rate. What does it mean? It means that the patency, no difference between sclerotinized and pedicle. That is the gold standard. And this one, also the meta-analysis, and he conclude from the study that in term of patency, sclerotinized IMA appear to be non-inferior to pedicle IMA. And what about the second conduit? We know that lima to LAD is the main target, main purpose. This data compare between the second arterial conduit, compared right IMA and radial artery, and he found that bilateral MA better survival and re-intervention than radial artery. However, another paper opposite from two center, the number of cases is 2,500 cases at 10 and 15 years. Survival, no different, but major adverse event, radial artery better than bilateral MA, especially in diabetic patient, COPD, and patency of 5 years, no difference significantly. Look at this slide. This slide from Cleveland Clinic, study by Bruce Leiter in 2004. This slide tell that how old of the patient that we can get the benefit of bilateral MA, and he conclude from his study that the, for American patient, not for the Thai patient, age more than 75, the benefit from bilateral MA less than the age younger. And what about guideline said? I have to quick my slide. For the American guideline, he said that if possible, the left IMA should be used to bypass to the left anterior descending artery. And the second thing, when anatomical and clinical suitable use of bilateral IMA to the circumflex or to the right coronary artery, decrease the re-intervention. What about the European side guideline said that the routine scrutinized IMA should be considered, and scrutinized IMA dissection is recommended in patients with diabetes or when bilateral IMA are harvested. And the arteriograph with IMA to the LAD system is recommended. Bilateral IMA graph should be considered in the patient younger than 70 years old. This is European guideline. Remember, from American side, from the study of Cleveland Clinic, they recommend the patient younger than 75%, we can get the benefit of bilateral IMA. And the recommendation of guideline in 2015 by Society of Thoracic Surgeons of America, they recommend to minimize the sternal wound friction with bilateral IMA by the first one, smoking of the patient have to stop. The second one, scrutinized graft should be considered. The third one, in glycemic patient control should be considered. That means you have to control the blood sugar of the patient very well, and enhanced sternal stability may be considered for the bilateral IMA. What about our experience? We have done bilateral IMA for just only 2 years, and in 33 cases, male and female, about 76 for male and 24 for female. The average age of the patient in this group very young, just 54 years old, and nearly 50% diabetes. And we are very lucky that we have no deep sternal wound infection. We just have the just only one case superficial wound infection. However, we have one serious problem for the bilateral MA, that the patient has partial phrenic nerve paralysis after the operation, both sides. So the patient has a symptom of she can lay down on the bed, at she had to sit up or on the left side up, right side up, and finally she gradually improved. I think that she has just only partial phrenic nerve paralysis, and now she look better after that. Ladies and gentlemen, I can conclude from my presentation that LIMA is the base conduit in CVG. Either the diabetes or non-diabetes patient, the second one, bilateral IMA is considered in young patient. And for the diabetes patient, scrutinized dissection is recommended. Radial conduit is considered in 90% lesion for the right side and 70% for the left system. Favor no different long-term influence of diabetes in arterial conduit. Saphenous vein gap is still used for the less important targets. And finally, sequential anastomosis, except LIMA, is better result than one-to-one anastomosis. And my last slide come back to our father of medicine that ความสำเร็จที่แท้จริงไม่ได้อยู่ที่การเรียนรู้แต่อยู่ที่ความสามารถในการประยุกต์ให้ความรู้นั้นเกิดประโยชน์แก่มวลมนุษยชาติครับขอบคุณครับ Thank you This picture just only last week when I went to Ho Chi Minh City
Okay Is there any question from the floor And I have the one question If the patient is the young people with the poor LV function do you use the one IMA or you use the bilateral the IMA for the patient
Really interesting question and very hard to answer I think that you have to balance between the benefit and the risk to the patient if the even though the patient has a low ejection fraction but in the operating theater the thing that we monitor is the first one is the blood pressure the second one is pulmonary pressure if the pulmonary pressure is normal or not too high and young patient I might do bilateral IMA and for sure I use the LIMA and if the pulmonary pressure high more than 25 my strategy I put the aortic balloon pump to the patient and I wait during I take the conduit the saphenous vein and after aortic balloon pump work the PA pressure come down to normal less than 20 I might progress bilateral IMA or I might do I for sure I use the LIMA to LVD I think that I answer your question
Thank you so much for the nice presentation and so we will move on to the next section for the next speaker
and the next speaker is the famous surgeon from Japan I'd like to invite the professor Hiroshi Nenemi in the topic of the how to harvest skeletonized internal membrane artery. He is the professor and the chairman of the Department of the Cardiothoracic Surgery in the International Medical Center Saitama Medical University in Japan. And please, professor.
Can I sit? Okay. Is it okay? Can I stand now? Thank you very much. Okay. Hi. Good morning, everybody. I'm very honored to be here with you today. Dr. Child and Dr. Shusak, thank you very much for inviting me for this meeting. And so let's start. Sorry. Mr. Chairman and ladies and gentlemen, I'm very happy to share with my experience with the concept of the LIMA harvesting with the harmonic scalpel, a method which is more popular used in Japan. For CABG compared to other countries. And this harmonic scalpel is very popular to be used in the general surgery field, but not very popular in cardiac surgery. But in Japan, it's very popular. Before talking about the harmonic scalpel, I'm going to talk about a little bit about the why we need to utilize more and more arterial graft, which is already Dr. Shusak mentioned previous talk. But I just repeat this. This is my center named Saitama Medical University International Medical Center. We are first academic center in Japan to obtain JCI certification in 2015, which is last year. But the JCI is very popular in Thailand. I heard you have like 200 centers obtain this certificate, but in Japan only like I think a little bit more than 10 centers obtained this certificate. So you are already familiar with this JCI. The Saitama Prefecture is probably, if you visited Japan, people go Tokyo and Kyoto, but you don't know where is Saitama. The Saitama is located just above Tokyo. And my center is about 50 kilometers away from the center of Tokyo. Okay, let's start about the cabbage. The choice of treatment for coronary artery disease, whether it should be PCI or cabbage, is still a big fight between cardiologists and cardiac surgeons. We surgeons know which is the best. 5-year follow-up from the Syntax trial has been released. As you know, after 5 years, CABG demonstrated more favorable results than the PCI. At 5 years, stroke was also not negatively influenced by CABG, even though the rate of OPCAP was very low in this study. The conclusion of this trial was that surgery remained the gold standard for patients with multivessel disease. In this round, CABG is the clear winner. In spite of these results, PCI utilization is still very strong. In Japan, the ratio is greater than 20 PCI procedures for every one CABG. Whenever we keep saying to cardiologists, I don't know how many cardiologists in this conference room, but to follow guidelines and evidence-based medicine, they can answer that at the gatekeeper, they will decide no matter what we surgeons think. When you look at the goal of each procedure, they may appear the same. This is because both treatments try to increase coronary blood flow beyond the disease segment. However, these treatments are not identical. These two appear as a resemblance to each other, but they are very different. This is very similar, but they're different. Okay? The same thing, it's different. So what I want to emphasize is PCI and the CABG is quite different. It looks very similar. So I wonder why, because the Syntax trials show the big advantage of our treatment. Why are the long-term outcomes of the CABG superior to those seen with the PCI? Endothelial vasodilatory substance might be the answer as to why the long-term outcomes of the modern CABG are superior to those of PCI. The arterial endothelium produces and releases three different vasodilatory substances into the blood vessel to maintain homeostasis: prostacyclin, nitric oxide, we call NO, and endothelium-derived hypopolarizing factor, EDHF. Importantly, the ITA graft can produce more of these three substances than other conduits, grafts, such as radial artery, saphenous vein, and gastroepiploic artery. This figure is a little bit a busy slide, but this slide explains why the possible reason why the CABG with ITA is superior to PCI. ITA produces vasodilatory substance such as nitric oxide, NO, which can protect to macrovascular disease. Again, it looks the same, but it's different. So what I want to mention is the ITA graft can function not only as a non-diseased living conduit, but also as a source of favorable metabolic substance that protect the coronary artery from further atherosclerosis progression. coronary stents, PCI, however, cannot protect the downstream coronary artery from the atherosclerosis process. So they keep improving device, but they never went to the ITAs. Attacking only the lesion will never be a fundamental solution to this problem. I just want to emphasize why ITA is so good. This is don't teach fish to swim to surgeons. But I just want to, I don't know how many cardiologists here, but I just want to remind why our cabbage is better than the PCI. And the audience here should remember this. Okay, let's go to down to the business again. So why skeletonization technique? Already, Dr. Shusak is already explained by using several slides. So I will use almost the same slide. But why we choose skeletonization technique for harvesting the ITAs? Here are the most recent guidelines on myocardial revascularization from Europe. In the section of the procedural aspect of the CABG, they recommend to use of the skeletonization technique to harvest ITA, especially in patients with diabetes and when bilateral ITA are used. The conventional pedicle technique harvest the ITA, including surrounding tissues, as a block, whereas skeletonization technique takes down only the ITA, leaving the surrounding tissues on the chest wall. What are the advantages and disadvantages of using skeletonization technique for ITA harvesting? There are several advantages and disadvantages. I think this is the most important advantage of this technique, is lower incidence deep sternal infection. Again, already Dr. Shusak mentioned, but I'll just repeat, okay? Theoretically, skeletonization technique maintains blood flow to the sternum through the collateral circulation. As you see, by this slide, sorry, I'm not sure, yeah. So the pedicle wave, we cut all of these things. So the collateral circulation doesn't maintain. But skeletonization technique, we only cut here. So this circulation maintains. That is very good for the sternum circulation. Of course, it's much less with the mainstream. But still, better than the pedicle way. This meta-analysis compared the incidence of sternal wound infection after CABG between skeletonized and the pedicle ITA harvesting. They concluded that the use of skeletonized ITA grafts appeared to reduce the incidence of postoperative sternal wound infection when compared to the pedicle ITA grafting. And this effect is moderated by the presence of the diabetes. And even in the United States, they don't use so much the bilateral ITA, but the rate of the bilateral ITA usage in the United States is, by the SDS database, only 4%, that they say. And they never use the bilateral ITA in patients on diabetic with the insulin. But we do. We use the patient with the diabetic with insulin. Doesn't matter they are on insulin or not. So next advantage of skeletonization technique is less pain. This paper is from Australia. They compare the incidence of postoperative pain between skeletonized ITA harvesting and the pedicle harvesting in the prospective double-blind clinical trial. Compared with the pedicle harvesting, skeletonized ITA harvesting provides a short-term reduction in the incidence of chest wall pain after CABG. Other advantages of the skeletonization technique include increased ITA diameter and the floor capacity and the length. This is a meta-analysis examining the effectiveness and the safety of different harvesting techniques. With scandalized technique, the ITA can be 2 cm longer, 0.13 mm bigger, and have 23 cc higher flow capacity. So in terms of the disadvantages of skeletonization technique is time consuming and technically demanding. However, the ultrasonic scalpel, such as a harmonic scalpel, can solve these problems. I'm going to briefly introduce harmonic technology, with heat generated by high frequency ultrasonic vibration between active blade and the tissue. The harmonic scalpel seals and coagulates tissues and then simultaneously cut blood vessel up to 5 mm diameter. In addition, this device does not pass electrical current through the patient's body. Instead of joule heat, the harmonic utilizes frictional heat generated by high-frequency ultrasonic vibration to generate protein and form coagulum, sealing blood vessel. Since the temperature only goes up to 60 degrees, heat due to surrounding tissue is minimized. What's the difference between harmonic and diatomy electrocautery? This video shows the difference in thermal damage between harmonic and the diatomy system. You can easily tell. The up one, this one is the diatomy, and the lower one is the harmonic. So that's lots of the thermal damage using the diatomy. The harmonic scalpel makes skeletonization technique easier, reducing harvesting time and minimizing invasiveness when compared with the conventional method. I'll show you the advantage of using the harmonic scalpel for harvesting the ITA. The first, one of the advantages of the harmonic usage, it can be time reduction. This is from the Canada. They compared outcome, including adverse events and harvesting time, from two groups where the skeletonization technique was used to harvest the ITA. In one group, harmonic scalpel was used to harvest the for the skeletonization technique, and the other was the performed using without harmonic scalpel, which means they are using the electrocautery. This slide shows the perioperative and the midterm outcomes of non-harmonic and harmonic patients. There are no difference seen between two groups. This slide shows the absolute risk difference for major adverse events between non-harmonic and harmonic patients. Again, there are no difference found between two groups. This figure is quite interesting. It's difficult to understand. So this is a decrease in harvest times per ITA by the number of commemorative surgery performed over time. The blue dot, I'm not sure, this blue dot represents the first 49 non-harmonic patients, and the green dots represent the harmonic patient. This nothing here is because they stop counting, okay? And the red line represents the mean value for the non-harmonic patient and the last 100 ITAs harvested. with a harmonic scalpel. There are a significant non-linear decrease in harvest time per ITA as illustrated by the green line. So definitely the time is reduction occurs, but needs a little bit to practice. I believe another advantage of this method might be better suitability for use in sequential bypass grafting because of a generally longer graft length and absence of surgical creeps. Between April 2011 and March 2014, 403 patients underwent CABG with at least one ITA graft in my center. This figure shows the number of sequential bypass grafting by ITAs. This table shows the number of sequential bypass cases performed by the left ITA and the right ITA. Since we use the right ITA primarily for grafting to the LID, sequential bypass is performed much more frequently using the left ITA. Not many cases, but 3 sequential bypass was performed by left internal thoracic artery LITA when you don't use the surgical creeps. It is more convenient to select site of the ITA for anastomosis. This is one of the example. As you can see, it's hard to see, but no creeps on the ITA side. There are some creeps, but that's on the chest wall, not on the ITA. This is a sequential performed by the ITA, high lateral, obtuse marginal, and posterior lateral branch. You might question whether or not the sealing of the side branch without surgical creeps is really safe. That's maybe the major question. The same time period, we also counted the number of the surgical creeps. And the average number of the creep used was less than one in both groups, left mammary and the right mammary. And there are no re-exploration required due to ITA side branch breeding in this study. So it would appear this technique is quite safe in terms of the side branch sealing. So yesterday I demonstrated how do we do the ITA harvesting using harmonic scalpel. But I'm going to show you the technique again. There are several types of the harmonic scalpel, but we use this type. It's called the dissecting Fuch type. And I demonstrated yesterday, I used also the gastroepiploic artery, and then I use the scissors type. So, but for the harmonic, we should use the dissecting Fuch type. And this device can be extended to deep area. Okay, I'll show you the video. The harmonic scalpel is I'm not saying I use the completely using only the harmonic scalpel. I use a diatomy too. So this is a left internal mammary. It's now I'm cutting the branch of the mammary and gently pull down the mammary artery. So this is the side branch. And another advantage using the harmonic is like this. We can peel off, clean up the fat tissue using the harmonic. This maneuver you can do with the diatomy. And you can extend the length. I'm now cutting, this is a mammary vein, not the artery. So I normally I go up to the under the subclavian vein, and now I'm making the tunnel pathway for the mammary artery, and then I put a small gauze on the top of the mammary, and spray the papaverine. And after like 5 minutes, it expand, and you will see the very good flow. Okay. This is another example of the Lita diagonal LED sequential. And without the clips, we can maximize the arterial graft. Harmonics can also be used when faced with the situation where the coronary is covered by the very deep fat tissue, like this. The advantage using this device is that this does not pass electric current through the patient body, so you don't have any arrhythmia. If you use a diatomy, you might get the ventricular fibrillation, but a harmonic scalpel is very safe. So this is another advantage using this harmonic scalpel. This will be my last slide. Yesterday's conference, Dr. Shusak mentioned that Japanese op-camp rate is around 90%. That is not true. Our op-camp rate, this is not my center's rate, about 70%. And this is almost constant for these 10 years. And the reason why we use so much off-pump cabbage is because the cardiologist in Japan is very strong. As I mentioned, the ratio of the PCI and the cabbage is 1 to 20. And then what they refer, I mean the cardiologist refer to us, the patient, cabbage patient, is a very diseased patient. So, and sometimes the ejection fraction is less than 30%, 25%. So those patients, the off-pump cabbage is very beneficial. That's why we have to use this technique, otherwise cardiologists don't send us the patients. That's a major reason. And my center, we do 97% off-pump. So, but I want to emphasize, what is the most important thing for the cabbage is, of course, I like off-pump cabbage, but most important thing is arterial grafting. And to maximize the arterial graft, skeletonization technique is very, very important. And the harmonic skeletonization technique is very beneficial to harvest the mammary artery. Thank you very much for your attention.
Any question from the floor?
Sorry. I have one question. During we dissect the scrutinized technique, I read from one paper that they recommend not to trauma internal mammary vein, because they say that when we trauma to the vein, the blood flow come back less, and then the incidence of wound infection increase. What is your idea?
Well, I'm sorry, I didn't follow you.
Try to protect internal mammary vein.
Yeah.
Yeah, not to damage the vein.
You mean the don't cut the vein?
Yeah.
Yeah, but you know, if you want to maximize the length of the internal mammary artery, you have to cut the vein. Otherwise, that's the internal mammary vein interfere the course of the internal mammary artery. Mm-hmm. And I'm doing this way for more than 15 years. Mm-hmm. I don't have any problem. Mm-hmm. So I don't think that the vein damage is not so important issue.
Mm-hmm. I read just only one paper that mentioned, but I'm not sure exactly. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, used to say like for the GEA is the same thing. People say GEA's vein, don't do the skeletonized way for the GEA, but we keep doing and we don't have any problem. So I don't know. this is true or not, but at least from my 10 years experience, I don't think that the pain is not a big issue.
Can I have a second question? What is the last case size of the side branch of the internal memory that can cut by the harmonic scalpel? What is the last case size of the side branch that can cut by the harmonic without breathing? What's your opinion?
Excuse me, I don't follow you. What?
The last case size of the side branch of the internal memory that we cut by the harmonic scalpel. What is the last case size that can cut by the harmonic scalpel?
You mean the end?
What? At the side branch.
Side branch?
Yes.
Yeah, we cut by the...
What is the last case size that can cut without bleeding? Or every branch, side branch, can cut by the harmonic scalpel?
Yeah. Yeah.
But without bleeding?
Okay. They say up to 5 millimeter, which is quite big. But it's 5 millimeter for me, it's too big. But the side branch is less than, the biggest one is less than 1 millimeter. So which is okay. So it's a safe. The Johnson & Johnson said that up to 5 millimeter, we can cut by the harmonic scalpel. The mammary artery itself is less than 5 millimeter, like a 3-4 millimeter. So which means side branch is much, much smaller than the that diameter. So it's very safe, even the big one.
Thank you. You have any question?
Okay.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Professor Hiroshi Ninami. Next, may I invite Dr. Chusak Kasem San to present a token of appreciation to the distinguished speaker. After the interesting topic, let's take a 15-minute break outside. Please enjoy your break, and when you return, we will have many more interesting topics for you. Thank you. Let's get started. Welcome again. I hope you feel refreshed. Here, the last program in this morning is very interesting. The moderator will be Dr. Chakapan Champathet and Dr. Omjai Ratananon. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. And the next topic is the choice of bioprosthesis in the CABG with AVR. This topic will be presented by Dr. Chung Chua Chong. He is the director of the Division of the Medical Informatics from the Yonsen Medical Center. Dr. Chong, please.
What's happening? Okay. It's coming. สวัสดีครับ Mr. Chairman Professor Chusa It is my great honor and pleasure talking at the 14th CCIT CVT annual meeting I'd like to appreciate the organizing committee and my topic this morning session is a choice of biostatic valve in coronary artery bypass grafting with aortic valve replacement A bioprosthesis is recommended in patients of any age for whom anticoagulation therapy is contraindicated, cannot be managed appropriately, or is not desired. Usually a mechanical prosthesis is reasonable, as you know, for AVR or AVR in patients' ages less than 60 years. However, a bioprosthesis is reasonable in patients' ages more than 70. What about patients between 60 and 70 years of age? Either bioprosthetic or mechanical valve is reasonable. The patient is 62 years old now. When he was 42, he underwent aortic valve replacement and coronary artery bypass grafting, LAD to the lima and the diagonal branch from the aorta. But 20 years later, saphenous vein graft was occluded as we can expect it, but Lima A is very patent and he is very good in health for 20 years. There's no argument for bioprosthesis in patients ages more than 70 years of age, and there is no argument to use Lima or Lita for left anterior descending coronary artery. However, questions remain still, ages under 70 or 65 years old. Porcine versus pericardial valve prosthesis for aortic position. What about brand of prosthesis, such as designs, anti-calcification treatment, or size of prosthesis, operation indication of mild or moderate aortic stenosis. Tissue bioprosthesis have been developed for the past 50 years since Professor Carpentier treated the Carpentier-Edwards valve since 1968. There are stented pericardial valve here, stented porcine valve, and stentless valve. As we know, Professor Carpentier had been devoted heart valve surgery since 1968 with a tissue valve treatment with glutaraldehyde, as you know. However, problems of bioprosthesis are tissue tearing with fatigue, calcification, and perforation with degeneration, penis formation, or other immunological degeneration. Bioprosthesis, even recent development of anti-calcification treatment, durability of bioprosthesis are limited, especially in patients ages less than 65 years or 70 years of age. Lifetime risk of reoperation as a function of age as surgical AVR is demonstrated here. Below 65 years of age, more than 25% of patients requires reoperation due to structural valve deterioration, SVD. However, there are good news for patients requiring re-replacement of aortic valve bioprosthesis. TAVI, surgeons' surgical burden have been reduced with recently developed TAVI procedures. There are many kinds of TAVI valves recently, and therefore there are several options of choice of bioprosthesis for AVR in patients requiring coronary artery bypass operation. Valve-in-valve in patients requiring re-replacement of aortic bioprosthesis is a good option for later stage. 10 to 15 years later. For the past 60 years, there were 8,800 operations for the heart valve disease in our institute. Among them, there were 460 cases of CABG concomitant with the valve surgery. And this slide shows the annual number of CABG in red bar and annual number of valve surgery in blue bar in our institute. Combined CABG and heart valve surgery is about 10 to 15% at every year also, and it is increasing. So this is a very important topic at this time. The cause of increasing number of combined CABG and heart valve disease thought to be increasing age of surgical patients requiring coronary bypass surgery with or without heart valve disease. As you can see here in red line, mean age of CABG in 2015 was 65.5 years. However, mean age of CABG combined with aortic valve replacement or other valve surgery was 68 years, so much higher than that of AVR only. There are several issues regarding AVR combined with coronary artery disease. Older population, poor left ventricular function, especially in PCI era, highest surgical risk with coexisting diseases. In contrast to poor surgical candidate comparing to the previous era, surgical technique are advanced with myocardial protection as well as improved design and improved durability of prosthesis. In addition, there is an important issue for redo surgery in patients with previous CABG patients with a functioning IMA graft. So previously, in 1990s, CABG with valve surgery was not popular in our institute in Korea. For 15 years, there was only 62 cases of aortic valve replacement and coronary artery bypass grafting. And the surgical mortality was a little bit higher than that of aortic valve replacement, only 4.8%. Two-thirds of the patients were less than 70 years, male and female patients. Risk factors were age, diabetes, and renal insufficiency, as we can expect it. This figure shows observed surgical mortality of coronary artery bypass grafting with the aortic valve replacement of MVR for 22 national cardiovascular network in the United States between 1994 and 1997. Mortality rate of AVR combined with CABG is higher than that of CABG only. However, if we manage patients with modern surgical technology, surgical results have been better than before. This study is a retrospective cohort study of 1,800 adult patients over 65 years of age undergoing surgical AVR with or without coronary artery bypass grafting in UK, single UK center between 1996 and 2011. This cohort study included elderly patients ages more than 65 years of age who had undergone either elective or urgent AVR with or without coronary bypass grafting. The mortality for aortic valve replacement is 1.5%, excellent, and 2.3% for AVR and CABG. Patients in the AVR alone group had a slightly higher median survival of 10.9 years than AVR and the CABG group, which had a median survival of 9.6 years. So patients age is less than 70, the longevity of patients with AVR and or AVR and the CABG is longer than 10 years, we can expect. Gender and AVR CABG versus AVR were not significant predictor of long-term survival, but severely depressed LV function, COPD, chronic kidney disease, current smoke, and preoperative arrhythmia were demonstrated as predictors. In other words, LV dysfunction was an important risk factor for long-term survival. However, Dr. Sharapiani did not analyze the difference of late outcome between patients with a 17 and 19 millimeter prostatitis and 21 and larger of average size. And in hospital tests and post-operative complications are higher with reoperation for bleeding, pulmonary stroke, or hemofiltration. According to the report from the EACTS, STS, UK, and the Germany registry for the past 2 and 3 decades, there have been significant improvement of surgical result of CABG and heart valve surgery. However, surgical mortality of valve surgery concomitant to the CABG is high, about 5 to 6%, and is twice higher than AVR alone. Therefore, CABG with valve surgery are still a significant burden to heart surgeons. So LV dysfunction and the combined disease are risk factors for long-term survival as well as early outcome. To select a proper valve prosthesis, it is important to understand the long-term fate of prosthesis. There have been numerous clinical researches regarding long-term durability and the free from structural valve deterioration for the past 30 years. David from Toronto analyzed the long-term free from structural valve deterioration in patients with Hancock valve. They're divided into 3 groups, and we can expect free from SVD is declining steeply after 10 years in patients under 60. It is the same with the Carpenter-Edward supraannular SAV prosthesis. The left panel is overall survivor and the right one is SVD-free survivor. The Carpenter-Edward SAV bioprosthesis provide a similar outcome in patients aged 61 and 70 and older individuals. So in 2015, last year, Boginong reported regarding very long-term outcome after aortic valve replacement with the Carpenter-Edward Perimount. In selected patients 60 years or younger undergoing AVR with the Carpenter-Edward Perimount, the expected valve durability was 17.6 years in patients younger than 60. From 1986 and 2001, a total of 591 patients underwent AVR with the Carpenter-Edward Perimount valve in 9 hospitals in Japan. Factors that raised the risk of reoperation due to structural valve deterioration included younger age, less than 65, at operation, and history of prior operation. Recently, age limitation for selection of prosthesis has been decreased to 60. According to Dr. Brennan and associates from Duke University, long-term survival in patients ages below 70 in patients with a low risk group of STS probability of risk of mortality lives more than 8 years. After AVR alone and after AVR and the CABG. Therefore, it may be said that longevity or durability of bioprosthesis is important in patients ages 60s and the low risk group of STS PROM. This is a retrograde retrospective cohort study from UK, as I showed you before, undergoing surgical AVR with or without CABG. As we can expect it in patients with AVR and CABG, bypass time, ACS time are longer and the Euroscore were high. So durability of bioprosthesis in 60s is very important. Recently, Johnston from Cleveland Clinic reported long-term durability of pericardial bioprosthesis of Carpenter-Edward Perimount with 12,569 implants. And in this right panel here, patients are grouped according to age range. In ages less than 60 is a very high risk of structural valve deterioration and 10% every year. However, ages more than 60 incidence of SVD is relatively low, 10% at 10 years, one-tenth of incidence. Younger age, lipid-lowering drugs, prostasis patient mismatch, higher postoperative peak and mean aortic valve pressure gradient were associated with the explant for structural valve deterioration. The effect of gradient on SVD was great in patients younger than 60 years. So this slide demonstrates the importance of age and the aortic valve peak pressure gradient influencing explant SVD. Patients at 60s and peak aortic valve pressure gradient over 30 millimeter mercury seems to be very important risk factors for early degeneration. So they concluded that durability of Carpentier Perimount aortic valve is excellent even in younger patients. Explant for SVD is related to gradient at implantation, especially in younger patients. So strategies to reduce early postoperative aortic valve gradient, such as root enlargement or more efficient prostasis, should be considered. Is there any difference of long-term durability between bovine and pericardium, bovine pericardium and porcine valve for aortic stenosis, aortic prostasis? Ganapathy and associates from Duke University reported a retrospective analysis of all stented bioprosthetic AVRs in 2015 to understand the long-term survival. The authors divided into two groups, bovine pericardial AVR or porcine AVR. In bovine group, Carpentier Edward Perimount, Sorin Mitral Floor, St. Jude Trifecta were included. In porcine group, St. Jude Biocor, Carpentier Edward Porcine, Medtronic Hancock, and Mosaic Valve were included. There was no difference in survival between porcine valve and bovine pericardial valve for 15 years in patients older than 55 years. The free from requiring repeat AVR was 96% for porcine and bovine pericardium, and there was no difference. Unadjusted survival analysis stratified by small, medium, or large valve size implanted likewise demonstrated no difference between groups. However, as you can see here, two left and right, for small prostate size and large prostate size, it seems to me that survival of a small prostate is less than that of large prostate. They did not comment for this important finding. So the choice of porcine or bovine pericardial bioprosthesis does not appear to affect long-term survival or need for reoperation, regardless of valve size or patient age. However, valve size seems to be important. According to meta-analysis, pericardial prosthesis is slightly better in free from structural valve deterioration after 10 years, red bar. However, it may be better in some group of patients because of difference of mode of failure. Is the explant for SVD related to gradient at implantation? Maybe. These are recently developed bioprosthesis. The trifecta and the sodium valve is composed of a fatigue-resistant titanium stent with a pericardial leaflet attached outside of the stent instead of unlike to the Carpentier Edward, it is inside of a stent. Trifecta provides excellent hemodynamic and large orifice area, according to the St. Jude Medical Company. Does the brand of bioprosthesis designs matter? Probably. Du Mesny described the editorial regarding PPM with a tissue valve in General American Society of Echocardiography. EOA of 21. Carpentier, Edward, Magna, and Trifecta is 1.7, and they concluded that this development of a new design of aortic prosthesis, severe PPM soon be considered as near extension. I don't know yet. However, there are still PPM in 19 millimeter of prostatic because the size is not so much different. EOA of 19 of stented or stentless valve are between 1.1 and 1.3. No significant differences. Dr. Ugur and associate from Mayo Clinic reported the comparison of early hemodynamic performances of three aortic valve bioprosthesis also in 2014. A total 1,436 patients underwent AVR. The average mean gradient of trifecta here was lower even in 19 millimeter size. And the effective orifice area is larger at comparing to other valve prostatic. According to him, hemodynamic early hemodynamic post-operative performance of the trifecta bioprosthesis is favorable. Additional follow-up should be determined whether these small hemodynamic differences will persist or influence the later clinical outcome. Still, we don't know. Also, Dr. Vent from Germany analyzed the hemodynamic performance of trifecta against the Carpenter Edward Perimount, Magna, and Magna Ease. And the black bar is a trifecta. Only 19 millimeter trifecta were implanted in their series. Mean pressure gradient at discharge and at 6 months were compared. In result, mean pressure gradient were lesser in trifecta compared to the other valve, and also the lesser in trifecta at discharge and at 6 months. So they concluded that although mean pressure gradient and aortic valve area seems to be advantageous at 6 months follow-up with a new trifecta valve, multivariate covariance analysis, there is no inference of a prosthesis type or mean pressure gradient or aortic valve area. This is one case of, in our own case of our hospital, one of my colleagues operated in this patient. 71-year-old lady, and preoperative, there is a severe aortic stenosis and severe aortic regurgitation. And the problem is postoperatively, she underwent the AVR with a 19 millimeter trifecta, but postoperatively, the pressure gradient was very high. The systolic pressure gradient was, peak pressure gradient was 50, and the mean pressure gradient was 30. So it was, we don't know why. Early postoperatively, there's anemia and high cardiac output status may induce the PPM. In other words, in this patient, 71-year-old gentleman underwent aortic valve replacement with a 23 trifecta, and the pressure gradient postoperative one was 20 over 8, so we are very satisfied with this pressure gradient. So does the PPM, especially pressure gradient at implantation, matter? This is EOA, red one, with a tissue valve or mechanical valve. And as I showed you before, Dr. Dunesnil, EOA of 21 and 23 of Carpentier Magna and trifecta are larger than any other prosthesis. PPM occurs when EOA of prosthesis is physiologically too small in relation to the patient's body surface area. And previously, we reported the long-term result of aortic valve replacement according to the PPM in 2012. Free from cardiac-related death were low in patients with a severe PPM, IEOA less than 0.65. So in last, I'd like to show you a conclusion slide of Dr. Joseph Barbaria. They conducted a global multi-center prospective clinical study with the St. Jude Medical trifecta, aortic pericardial valve, and reported in 2014. Even 19 millimeter of prosthesis, average peak pressure gradient at discharge was 18, and 6 months later, it was 20 millimeter mercury, Also, EOA of 19 millimeter discharge was 0.9 square centimeters. So in severe PPM, we may expect the long-term survival was not satisfied. And therefore, I'd like to use this kind of nomogram for prevention of PPM at the time of AVR, especially with the cabbage. And if it is inevitable to use a large valve size, aortic root enlargement would be recommendable. So this is a simple procedure to make an incision to the non-coronary annulus and put the pericardial patch to enlarge the aortic annulus. And we may put the two sizes larger than the initial aortic valve. So lastly, I'd like to conclude with Dr. Diane's conclusion with the meta-analysis. In light of a result of present meta-analysis, severe PPM should be avoided in every patient undergoing aortic valve replacement, whereas preventive measures should be considered in patients with anticipated moderate PPM presenting vulnerability factor to PPM, including ages less than 70, body mass index less than 28, and concomitant coronary artery bypass grafting. Regarding average Korean lifespan of 80 for men and 84 for women, durability of tissue valve should be more than 15 years when we implant the bioprosthesis at or before 70 years of age. So thank you very much for your attention.
Hello. Is there any question from the floor? If not a question, thank you, Dr. Chung, for the nice piece. Oh, okay. Dr. Chu Sak, please.
I have a really short question. In the era of TAVI, is it possible for TAVI while involved and how size of the bioprosthesis that's suitable for while involved in your idea?
Well, up to last year, we have 100 cases of TAVI with good results. We have a TAVI team and select patients if it is a very high risk or intermediate risk with a STS score more than 5.0%. Well, with the TAVI error, it is very important to select the bioprosthesis because at this time, we cannot insert a TAVI valve less than 23 millimeter size of bioprosthesis. We don't know 10 years later we can make a better one or not, but that's why we have to put the bioprosthesis sizes more than 23. At least 21 should be implanted. No, I don't think 19 millimeter is good enough. So I'd like to try to put the aortic valve at least 21 millimeter in size, even in small patients. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Bo Shu Chang.
Hello.Okay, we're waiting for the next speaker. He come in, but we're waiting for up to the pro. And we'll talk show. Okay. Just wait. Wait a minute.
I have to share the experience that we do in Sirirat. So this is Sirirat Hospital for those who doesn't know. I think most of the people know Sirirat Hospital is right by Chao Phraya River. And we do roughly about 1,400 open heart cases per year. And of that, about 500 per year would be CABG. And this is a little bit old data, but it's the only data that quite complete that I have before I'm going to show you the recent data. This is a study from 2000 to 2006 on all the patients that have ejection fraction lower than 30%. Oh, this is accessed by echocardiography, by LV gram or cardiac MRI. So, and the emergency surgery, the patient with pre-op IABP, and patient with the concomitant cardiac procedure, the redo, and some patient who have insufficient data will be excluded. So at Sirirat Hospital at that time, there were 8 cardiac surgeons who performed open heart surgery and doing CABG, most of them doing a on-pump, classical on-pump with the cross clamp, and there are few op-cap. The technique is mild hypotermia, and there are 7 surgeons who give only antegrade, and the one surgeon who give combined antegrade and retrograde, it's me. So all the proximal anastomosis was done with the beating heart, partial aortic cross clamping, unless there's evidence of calcified ascending aorta. And the number of patients at that time who have CVLV dysfunction is 2,464. Cabbage, and there were 169. So it's about 6.9% of patients at that time who have LV dysfunction, with the age range from 41 to 81. The predominant of male. And if you look at the New York Heart Association class, they were predominantly class 2 and 3. And a lot of patients I also operate, not because of their symptom of heart failure, but because of their angina. So if you look at the classification of angina, they were mostly 2, 3, and 4. But so it's about 60% of the patients who have angina. And this is demographic data to show you. At that time, the previous PCI are only 5 to 6%, but I believe now there were more. About a little bit over half are diabetes. And the creatinine baseline varies from 0.5 to 4.2, but it appears that the patient in this group will have a little bit of higher creatinine compared to the normal patients. And that some of the patients also have dialysis as well. There were about 7.7% of patients who have cerebral vascular accident before. There were some patients have peripheral vascular disease, carotid artery stenosis. Most of them are in sinus rhythm. And the extent of the coronary disease is as shown. So, of course, they have surgery. So majority of them are at a triple vessel disease with 20% are left main. So the ejection fraction will range. This is cut out at 30. So the range of from 12 to 30 with the mean range of 24.6%. 103 patients were accessed by echo, and the 20% were accessed by cardiac CAT, LV gram, and MRI were by 39%. So, and this is the average of LVE, SVI, about 91.6. The Euro score, about 5.5. We look into the in-hospital mortality at that time, and there are three factors that involve in-hospital mortality. Number one is New York Heart Association. So if the patient have a worse heart failure, it seems to affect their mortality. And another one is the COPD. So the patient with COPD will have a higher mortality than the patient without COPD. And also the Euro score does affect the outcome as well. Another thing is the data that look into the data. Of all these patients there at that time, there are only 7 up pump procedure. Most of them are done by cardiopulmonary bypass. The mean CPB time is about 83 minutes, and a mean aortic cross clamp time is about 49 minutes. So there were 4 reoperations for bleeding, so it's not bad. And there are 8 patients with preoperative myocardial infarction. Despite having a EF less than 30%, the post-op ABP use is only 4.7% with the duration about a week. And a patient after surgery, they seem to be able to tolerate, not run into post-op heart failure. The prolonged use of inotrope is about 66%. So that's the only thing that we face is in this group of patients, we should not be weaning them off inotrope too quickly. And the post-op arrhythmia, mostly atrial fibrillation, which is about 26%, and for VTVF is about 3.6%. So despite we learned that patients with EF less than 30%, they could have a ventricular storming, but look at our data, that's about 3.6%. The creatinine is range from 0.5 to 12, with a mean of 1.92. About 41% of the patients, however, have the creatinine change up to 3-fold during post-operative period. And the patient required dialysis about 8.3%. At that time, we were doing a lot of peritoneal dialysis, more than hemodialysis, but nowadays we're doing mostly hemodialysis. The complication are perfusion and pneumonia, and there are some cerebral vascular accident, about 1.8%. The patient, only one patient had GI complication, and the prolonged intubation is about 13%. The length of ICU stay about range from 1 to 69 with a mean of 4. So, and the length of hospital stay is about 10 days. The in-hospital mortality from cardiac cause and non-cardiac cause all combined about 6.9%. So if you look at the preoperative data that influenced mortality. There were 4 of them. One is the postoperative ABP use. So the patient who use ABP seem to have a problem later on. The patient who have dialysis, and the patient who have pneumonia, and the patient who have prolonged intubation. So now we look at the survival curve over 5 years. In this group of patients and their survival over 5 years, about 82.7%, which is, I would consider, pretty good. The freedom from heart failure is about 80%. And the freedom from angina is about 91.4%. So if you look at the New York Heart Association class, you can see that before surgery, they're predominantly class 2 and class 3. So at 1 year and 5 years after surgery, you have more of a class 1 and class 2. So what you help a lot is reduce class 3 and class 4. All these patients actually not only have CBG, but they also have a medical protocol for heart failure afterwards. And this is the medication that we use at that time. So there were beta block, spironolactone, naloxone, and the ACE inhibitor. So the severe LV dysfunction was associated with increased risk of all-cause preoperative mortality. Our survival in 5 years about 82.7% with the freedom from heart failure, almost 90% in 1 year and 80% in 5 years. And the freedom from angina is about 95% in 1 year and 91% in 5 years. So most of the patient's symptoms are improved. They also receive medical treatment the same before and after surgery. And the risk factor for preoperative mortality are functional class, COPD, Euro score, the prolonged intubation, postoperative ABP use, requirement of dialysis, and a postoperative pulmonary complication, which is pneumonia. So in our center, the CBG in patients with severe LV dysfunction carry increased mortality about 6.9%. The postoperative symptoms are better and seem to have an acceptable 5-year survival. So this is the limitation of our study. It is a retrospective study, and the EF measurement was not the same in every patient. And we did not do a myocardial viability test routinely before surgery. Now, looking to our recent data from this past 4 years, the total number of CBG as you can see, about 450 to 500. So for isolation CBG, so it's about 400 to 450, and EF less than 30% is a little bit over 40 patients in every year. So, and if you accept the last year, we are only half year through, and this is 7.2% already. So it seems like the number of patients with the EF less than 30% is roughly about 5 to 7% in our recent data. And the mortality, if you compare one that have EF less than 30% with the one with the EF equal or more than 30%, you will see that the mortality is about double of the patient with the EF less than 30%. So this is about 2.5, 2.2, and this is about 5.3 to 5.6%. So you can see the mortality does increase with the patient in this group. So if you look at the prognosis significant of ischemic patient with cardiomyopathy, the one who have best prognosis is a peripartum cardiomyopathy, because same as myocarditis, once they get better, they're almost like normal. And idiopathic cardiomyopathy actually have a little bit better prognosis than cardiomyopathy from ischemic heart disease. If you look at the treatment in the past about surgical treatment for ischemic heart failure, all the study in the past, this is the one that we used to study, the VA study, the European study, the CAS study, and all the small study. The CBG does associate with the mortality reduction. Most of the study compared with medical management, the time that is not the PCI time at that time. So the did show clearly that CBG does improve survival. However, most of the patients have a normal LV EF. So, and 90% have angina, 80% have normal LV EF, and 10% have atrial conduit. And that time, the medical therapy is only digoxin and diuretics. Until about almost 10 years ago now, there were a study compare medical management, including PCI, with surgical management in the patient with LV dysfunction. The name of the trial is STITCH trial. This is one of the landmark trial that changed a lot of how we manage the patient who have ischemic cardiomyopathy. So this is the randomized non-blind study. So initially, there were patients who was EF less than 35%. If they divide into the group of medical management versus CBG, medical management versus CBG, versus CBG with surgical volume reduction. And the last group is the CBG versus CBG with surgical volume reduction. So, there were about 5 years follow-up at that time, almost 6 years. The study was published in New England Journal. Of all 1,212 patients who randomized to CBG versus medical therapy, there were no different in all-cause mortality in 56-month follow-up. However, 17 patients in the medical therapy does cross over to the surgical arm. So that time, for all-cause mortality, it's no different, even though the graph tends to favor CBG. But if you look at a mortality from cardiovascular death and combined outcome of death and cardiovascular hospitalization, CBG does also associate with a 30% reduction in mortality. So at that time, this trial did not reduce the all-cause mortality, but it does reduce the cause of death from cardiovascular. However, recently there were a stitches, so it's a stitch extension study where they follow this patient. So as you remember, there's 1,212 patients randomized. So they will follow up to about 13.3 years and 13.4 years maximum follow up. So median about 9.9 years and 9.8 years. So they will extend the follow up to 10 years. And this is the primary and secondary outcome. The primary outcome is death from any cause, which were equal, which were not significant when we follow the patient up to 56 months. But at 10 years, they were significant. So the CBG does have a advantage over medical therapy group in improving cause of death from any cause. And the secondary outcome, which is already better in the previous study, is death from cardiovascular cause, death from any cause or hospital for cardiovascular cause, death from heart failure. They were all better in the CBG arm. So if you look at Kaplan-Meier's survival, death from any cause, death from cardiovascular, everything favors CBG. And the subgroup analysis of death of any cause also favors CBG. So the result summarized as this: the rate of death from any cause over 10 years was lower by 16%. So in the patient with LV dysfunction, which is in stitch trial, the cutout is 35%, the rate of death is lower by 16% in 10 years. And the CBG was associated with an incremental median survival benefit of nearly 18 months. And the prevention of one death due to any cause for every 14 patients treated. So you treat 14 patients with lower EF with CBG, you will prevent one death. And for cardiovascular cause, would be every 11 patients treated. So in conclusion of the stitches trial is, in the cohort patient with ischemic cardiomyopathy, the rate of death from any cause, death from cardiovascular cause, and death from any cause or hospitalization combined were significantly lower over 10 years in a patient who underwent CBG in addition to receive medical therapy when compared to a patient who received medical therapy alone. In this case, medical therapy include PCI. So, however, you have to balance between, because if the patient have a very, very low EF, then they will increase risk of death as well. As in our experience at CVRAD, is about twice of the normal EF. So there will be some patient who will be favor medical therapy, some patient who favor CBG with medical therapy. So this is published in Journal of American College of Cardiology, where they propose about where should you balance the patient for medical therapy versus CBG. So of course, if the patient has triple vessel disease, have the larger volume of the heart, they seem to favor, or if they have mitral valve, moderate to severe mitral valve regurgitation, they will be favor CBG. If they have single vessel disease, they'll have a slightly higher EF, smaller heart, they may favor the medical therapy. So, thank you.
Any question from the front? Dr. Shevi.
Thank you very much for your informative presentation. May I ask one or two questions? I have seen that you described the route of quadriplegia. You have two different techniques. Most of them use the antiquated only, but only you use the combined technique. And is there any difference between the loss of quadriplegia? The first question. And the second question is that, do you have any problem about the ischemic mitral regurgitation during subgroup of ischemic cardiomyopathy?
So for the first questions about the route of cardioplegia, I think this is just a matter of preference where you train from. As I previously mentioned, I trained from Loyola University, where we are routinely doing both antiquated and retrograde. The rationale behind that, but no study support, is giving retrograde. You know, at least you could reach some certain part of myocardium where they have the atrial may not reach when they have severe stenosis or maybe diffuse disease. So retrograde may help protect the hearts better. Also, at the end of the case, it may help flush back some embolization, mainly air embolization. Also, there are some people who, including me, who give a hot shot, which is giving a warm cardioplegia to help the heart that they deplete the ATP. So their heart can be warm, get some substrate before they start beating. So it's just a matter of preference. My style is when I do the anastomosis, if I reach 20 minutes and I'm still working on it, then I ask them to give retrograde cardioplegia so I don't have to put the heart down. But if you give cardioplegia antiquatedly only, sometimes you have to put the heart down, otherwise you're causing AR. And the second question is about ischemic mitral regurgitation. Because the data that we look into and we present today, we exclude the concomitant procedure. So this is the only data for isolated CBT. However, we do see quite a number of ischemic mitral regurgitation. And they are usually just annular dilatation with the retraction of the papillary muscle. And most of them can be treated with putting a ring anuloplasty procedure. So most of our procedure that we perform at CIRADA are still doing the ring anuloplasty, even though there are data that in the patient who may be very sick, you can actually just go ahead and do the mitral valve replacement if you think the repair is difficult. But so far, we mostly just put the ring.
First question is that about the quadriplegia combined technique. You use both good LV or just only poor LV for combined?
For me, I use both.
Both?
I use all. I mean, the only patient that I don't give retrograde will probably the triple vessel disease that is no total occlusion. And I think I would do, I'm planning to do maybe three vessel bypass.
Can I?
Yes, please.
Thank you very much, Brian. That's a great presentation. This is not a question, it's kind of comment. Because we also recently analyzed our almost the same patient group, ejection fraction less than 30%, about 140 patients. And the op rate is almost 100% for the group of patients. And the mortality rate was around 2%. But the normal patient, I mean, including all group, the CABG patient, mortality is less than 1%, so, which is a little bit higher compared to the, double compared to the whole patient. But still, we can reduce the mortality because of the op-cap. Because I think the one of the advantage using op-cap is this group of patients. So what do you think?
Well, I think op-cap it's a good procedure. However, in our institution, including me, usually we you know, that's also a Cochrane review and all the study. So it's depend on how you look at. So in our experience, we more comfortable with on pump because of number one. The patient have quite a big heart, so it's when the bigger the harder the op cap, and then usually when the very big heart, you end up doing a quite distal target, which is small, and using a longer conduit. Mm. So in our experience, if we actually don't use the op cap strategy for the low EF. The only op-cap strategy we use will be, number one, is if they have a porcelain aorta, where we cannot clamp for sure. There are some patients who maybe they are in shock and we are reluctant to clamp. We may do a beating heart with support, with the pump support. So in terms of doing pure op-cap, I think it's institution preference as well. Yeah. Since we all do on pump, so all the junior also familiar with on pump. So to do a op-cap, and when I first start, I do quite a bit of op-cap, and I try to increase the number to 100. I was doing up to 40%, and I have to do routine. First of all, the routine case you have to do op-cap in order to be familiar and comfortable to do a difficult case. But I found out to me to let the resident perform on pump is much calmer. Yeah. So that's how at Sri Rat, heavily on pump. I think in Thailand, will be Ramathibodi and Rampang, they do heavily, a lot of predominantly op-cap. You go to other institution, I think there were less op-cap.
Yeah, you know, the many studies show that like a Ruby study show the no difference, and some papers show that worse the result using the op-cap technique compared to the conventional. Mm-hmm. But for us, you know, the strong op-cap believer, you know, this type of patient is more beneficial. But this is very difficult to do the study comparing the op-cap, on-pump CABG, conventional CABG for this type of the patients, like a low ejection fraction. But I believe that this is the most beneficial the patient group using the op-cap technique. Just my comments. Thank you.
Okay, time up. I would like to say thank you to Dr. Panyasakyalak and close the section now and move on to the lunch symposium.
Thank you, Dr. Paranya Sakyalak. After those interesting topics, I think you will be happy to know we now have a lunch break in this meeting room. The lunch box wheels are taped to you in this room. The topic in lunch lecture is very interesting. The moderator will be Dr. Chusak Kasem San. Dr. Chusak, please.
Thank you, my pretty MC. It's a time for lunch. So we have a topic for during the lunch symposium. The topic is trifecta and biobental experience, sponsored by St. Jude. The speaker is Dr. Bong Chu Chang. Again, please. Our friend from Korea.
Swadikar again. Well, thank you, Dr. Chusak, to have a chance to talk my talk at this time for luncheon symposium. I'd like to talk about the trifecta and the biobental with a video clip, how to operate. But this luncheon symposium, it is very difficult to focus on the lecture. So first, I'd like to show you a video clip, which was made by myself last week. So. Well, this is a 72-year-old gentleman who had a severe aortic stenosis with regurgitation. And we decided to replace the aortic valve with a trifecta. And as you can see here, the incision of aorta is very important. We every time make an aortotomy incision at the sinotubular junction. I think it is very important one. And after cardioplasia, we lift the proximal part of ascending aorta to the upward to view the surgical field very well. And this is a severe aortic stenosis with some calcification. In this case, it is much easier to remove the aortic valve because the calcification is not so severe. And after removal of this diseased aortic valve, we remove all the calcium debris and tissues around the aortic annulus to make a bigger aortic annulus. And after removal of all calcium debris and tissue, we put measure the aortic root with a trifecta sizer, the supra one and intra one. So as you can see here, the suture techniques, there are several suture techniques. I prefer the figure A sutures for aortic valve replacement. For the past 25 years, I have used this figure A sutures. The suture technique is very important to reduce the PPM and improve the bigger size, well, put the bigger size of aortic prostasis. This is the left side coronary annulus. And after sutures at the left coronary annulus, I usually use the small piece of pericardial strip to reinforce the annulus tissue, because sometimes there's a breakage of muscle when we tie down the valve in the position. So this is a very simple one to put to enforce the sutures at the muscular part. This is a place between left and right coronary annulus, as you understand. And at this area, I put the matrix sutures with the pericardial reinforcement. And the big sutures for right coronary sinus, because the muscular tissue sometimes is very pliable, weak, and maybe break when we put the annulus, the prostasis. At this place, as we know, the conduction tissue is along this place, and I put the matrix sutures between the right and non-coronary annulus. And this part, non-coronary annulus, is very strongest part of the aortic annulus, and make a big sutures, including a base of the anterior mitral leaflet. I will tell you why here is important. So this is a trifecta 23 millimeter. We usually use the 15 to 18 sutures around the aortic annulus. And after selection of the aortic valve prostasis, we sutured the valve sutures to the graft prostasis. It is another important one is to suture the annulus one-third outer from the sawing cuff. This is the sutures of left coronary annulus. And next, we move to the right coronary annulus. And every time I measure the half of the annulus sutures and put the sutures at the same area of right coronary annulus to put the correct position. I'm using two Etibond sutures for the past 25 years with the figure eight sutures. At the non-coronary annulus, the nadus of the non-coronary annulus is very deep. So if we place the prostasis at the annulus, sometimes, you know, it does not move to the correct position of annulus. So strong bite to the non-coronary annulus is very important. Next, when you see this place, sinotubular junction is very narrow in this case. In other words, we choose the biggest aortic prostasis, and we tilt down the prosthesis to put the annulus easily. We cannot put the valve inside of the annulus with the same position. We tilted the prosthesis and pushed down to the annulus. After placement of the prosthesis, we tie down the sutures from the left coronary annulus, because when there is some breakage of the left annulus, it is very difficult to repair, or it's sometimes it is a disaster. So we put the left side very carefully first, and then we move to the right annulus, and 50%, half of the annulus tie down first to check the correct position of the prosthesis to the native aortic annulus. So at this part, the suture should be very careful not to tear the muscular tissue of the ventricular septum. That's why we put a small strip of pericardial strip to reinforce the annulus. So at this part, we have to check the correct position of prosthesis contact to the annulus, because sometimes it cannot be positioned at the same, the correct position. And after the implantation of the prosthesis, we can see here there's no obstruction or stenotic area at the left ventricular outflow tract. Lastly, it is important to close the aortotomy site, because the saurian mitral flow or this trifecta, the stent is straightforward 90 degrees, so sometimes we may suture this stent without if we do not care about that. So we put the patch stitches, annular metal suture first to prevent first to suture the prosthesis, and second to good hemostasis. And this suture makes a narrowing of a sinotubular junction, and it may be important for hemodynamic rheology of the aortic LV outflow tract. So these continuous material sutures prevent some injury to the prosthesis, as well as a good hemostasis, and reduce the sinotubular junction for natural hemodynamic status. After running sutures with the annular matrix suture, we put the over and over suture again. I am using every time fiber prolin, because in Korean patients, the aortic tissue is very thin and pliable. And if you use the 3-O prolin, there's a significant serious bleeding problems when we use, especially in aortic stenosis. So after sutures with the running over and over sutures, we give a warm shot, warm blood cardioplasia at this time to resuscitate the heart. I am every time using the Buckberg solution and warm blood cardioplasia for the past 15 years, and for the past 5 years, 1,000 cases, I have never used the IABP. I have just one case of ECMO among 1,000 cases. So blood cardioplasia and the correct warm cardioplegic shot is very important for protection of myocardial preservation. As you can see here, there's no bleeding at all after close of the LT. And there's a sinotubular junction narrowed with the sutures, so it can be maintained for a long time. And every time I'm put using the HR pacing lead. So this is a looks very simple LT valve replacement, but sometimes if we missed some important pitfall for during aortic valve replacement, there will be disasters in some case of bleeding, conduction block, or paravalvular leakage. Thank you very much for your attention.
Any question or comment from the floor? I have a really short question about the technique of implantation of diaphragma. Any different from other tissue valve for the tip and trick of diaphragma in your experience?
I'd like to talk about our other.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, process. You finish your talk?
I have another talk.
Okay.
Yes. Can I start? Okay, thank you. Well, as we know, Professor Carpentier had been devoted to heart valve surgery since 1968 with a tissue valve treated with the glutaraldehyde, as I told you before. Nowadays, we are expecting 25 years of durability of tissue valve in aortic position, especially in patients ages of 70 years. And nowadays, we are expecting 25 years durability. And heart valve surgery has been started since 1956 in our institute from closed mitral commissurotomy. And as I showed before, for the past 60 years, the mean age of patients were increased, and now mean age of patients were 61.5 years. Still, it is very young comparing to the United States or European country. And with increased age, with research and development, choice of valve prosthesis has been changed. The red bar is mechanical valve, and tissue valve is blue. So still, the percent of tissue valve in red line is increasing, but still, it's around less than 50% because of patient's age. This is a number of isolated aortic valve replacement in our hospital. We have used the various kind of prosthetic valve for the past 40 years since 1975. For the tissue valve, we used the Hancock valve since 1976 and the Carpenter-Edward valve since 1977. In 1980 and 1990s, we have used the mechanical valve, mostly St. Jude and the Carbomedics, in most of patients because of young age and young rheumatic in origin. Since 2010, number of tissue valve is increasing with the increase of age of patients. And recently, for the past 5 years ago, we were interested in TAVI valve and Sutures valve from the LivaNova and Intuit valve from Edwards. So we are using all of the valve product. Well, let me introduce one patient who underwent aortic valve replacement in 1978 when I was first year of resident. She was at the time 23-year-old young lady and operated for aortic regurgitation, rheumatic in origin. And this is a surgical report. And she underwent redo AVR with St. Jude Medical in 1992 after delivery of one daughter. And she underwent the mitral valve replacement and LV aneurysmectomy in 2011. She's really fortunate with the valve prosthesis. So we appreciate the valve prosthesis manufacturers and the scientists for continuous development for this kind of patients. For the past 60 years, many surgical procedures and valve prosthesis were developed with this research and new idea. Not all innovations represent progress. There is a truth that should be understood. Recently, there have been several reports for long-term durability of tissue valve more than 25 years. This is a report in vitro study, billion cycle in vitro, means 25 years of durability. As you can see in this slide, the tissue valve is very durable after billion cycle test. However, one in three 23 millimeter valve had a small tear at this area after 500 million cycle. So in 2014, Bavaria and other reported a global multi-center prospective clinical trials. In result, St. Jude Medical Trifecta is a unique pericardial valve with a design element that provide excellent hemodynamic performances and excellent two-year follow-up results. However, PPM is still debatable in long-term outcome. The concept of aortic valve PPM was originally introduced by Dr. Rahimtulla in 1970A. As I showed you before, EOA of 21 millimeter Carpentier Edward Magna and the trifecta is 1.7. And they concluded that with the development of a new design of aortic prostasis, severe PPM soon be considered as a next near extinction. However, there are still PPM with a 19 millimeter prostasis. So without the severe PPM, can we expect 25 years durability for tissue valve? We hope. Maybe there are many changes in our body, mechanically and biochemically. So we can change the biomechanical problems with the suture technique and with the selection of prosthesis. In many patients, small annulus may be overcome with a recently developed prosthesis named supraannular type of prosthesis. Schematically, we can explain three types of aortic valve prosthesis: intraannular, semi-intraannular, and the supraannular types. And these are recently developed bioprosthesis. The trifecta and the sorin mitral floor is composed of a fatigue-resistant titanium stent with a pericardial leaflet attached outside of the stent with a pericardial leaflet. Trifecta provides excellent long-term result at this time with a large orifice area. At this time, we know the supraannular type are better in design for less pressure gradient and larger EOA. Anti-calcification treatment would reduce early structural deterioration. What about the surgical technique? We have to understand what will be happen after aortic valve replacement regarding turbulence and the hemodynamics around the prosthesis. Anyhow, all the calcified tissue should be removed before implantation of prosthesis. It's the first surgeon's role. We reviewed the patients of aortic bioprosthesis for the past 20 years between 1995 and March 2015. There were 370 AVR with a tissue valve, Carpentier Edward 271 since 1995, and EPIC valve, porcine valve, 98 cases since 2008. The graph shows the prosthesis size of aortic valve replacement. There were a significant number of 19 millimeter prosthesis yet. This is very interesting data. When we analyze the valve size, according to the surgeons in our department, four surgeons, there was significant difference among surgeons. A and B surgeons are expert for CABG, C, D surgeons are primary valve surgeon. The A and B surgeons using 19 millimeter prosthesis, more than one-third of the patients. However, CD surgeons, they use 19 millimeter in 19% and 7.9%. Who is 7.9%? Can you expect? Myself, 7.9%. So it depends on surgeons' skill and experience. Although there was no significant difference in long-term survival between Carpentier Edward and EPIC valve, we need at this time longer-term study. Well, we have six late reoperation due to endocarditis, three after native endocarditis, and two early calcification in one Carpentier, one trifecta. And this year, we have two more cases with the trifecta. And I'm sorry, with the epic valve. Between since last year, we have a chance to use the trifecta for aortic valve replacement, and we have 28 cases of experience, AVR alone in 18, with MVR, mitral enloplasty, CABG, bioventral, 3 cases with the Valsalva graft, and the sizes of 19, 4, 21, 11, 23, 7 cases. And this is the pelvic size. And when we compare the trifecta with the Carpenter-Edward valve, this is a post-operative pressure gradient measured by echocardiography. As you can see here, with a 23 millimeter of trifecta compared with the 23 meter Carpenter-Edward, there is some significant difference of mean pressure gradient after the operation. So to prevent PPM, proper selection of size is important, and also proper selection of brand of the prosthesis is important. Let me show you one case of trifecta 19 millimeter. This is a 81-year-old lady, a severe aortic stenosis, and post-operatively, the valve functioning very well without the regurgitation. However, the post-operative pressure gradient was 52 over 28 in this special case. I don't know why it's so high. So maybe post-operative anemia induced the high output status and some high pressure gradient. However, we have to be careful to select the prosthesis, even in older, small ladies. This is another case for bioventral with the St. Jude 27. We are using Gelviva Valsalva graft, 28. If we use the 28, we reduce the one size. St. Jude trifecta 27, and if we use the 26, we use the 25 trifecta. In this case, the annulus size was 32, so even we reduced the annulus with the bioventral, the graft was 28. And this is preoperative regurgitation, and this is postoperative with a post-op TTE. As you can see here, the valve functioning very well inside of bioventral. That's the reason why I'm showing this one is that the trifecta is 90 degree of height of stent. So if you use the straight tube, the stent may adhere to the graft and may have a problem with the adhesions or penis formation to the valve tissue. So I do not recommend the trifecta for the Valsalva graft in ventral operation. So I'd like to recommend the Valsalva graft or the bioventral if you use the trifecta. And the mean pressure gradient is less than 20, peak and mean pressure less than 20 and 10. And already I showed you this PPM. EOAI less than 0.85 is a mismatch of the aortic prosthesis. The feasibility of an operation is not the best indication for its performance. So I'd like to conclude and summarize with this slide. Although early degeneration of tissue valve prosthesis in younger patients less than 65 were not solved at this time, durability of bioprosthesis are excellent, expecting 25 years more at this time in patients more than 70 years. PPM can be prevented with the supra-annular type aortic valve prosthesis. However, there are still problems with the 19 millimeter prosthesis, even we are using trifecta. Therefore, meticulous surgical techniques are important with the removal of all aortic valve tissue and the calcium debris. And what about suture technique? Some surgeons recommend the Pledge's everting tie may reduce the aortic valve prosthesis size. Pledge's may make a turbulence of the LVR outflow tract, so we don't know. In last, I'd like to emphasize that we have to consider valve replacement with EOAI more than 1.0 square centimeter per body surface area. Thank you very much for your attention.
Any comment from the floor or question? If not, I have a really short question about the technique of the trifecta. Any different from the technique that we use for other tissue valve, or the same technique of the suture?
You mean technique of sutures to place?
Yeah.
Well, I am using the same technique in every prosthesis, even mechanical valve, for the past 25 years, 30 years. But we have a small number of paravalvular leakage at the muscular part of right coronary annulus. That's why we are using pericardial strip for the past 15 years. So the number of paravalvular leakage was reduced significantly, but still there's a 1 or 2% of small paravalvular leakage, frankly speaking.
Any question? Sherwood, please.
Thank you very much for your presentation. May I ask you about the problem of the calcified sinus of our salva? Because some patient has calcification as at sinus of our salva, so aortic incision may be higher. That is it difficult to put the bioprosthesis or even trifecta in aortic position? Because I have problem with the sinus of our salva calcification and aortic incision may be higher than normal. So if patient is an old age, I still use the mechanical valve because as limitation of the height of the bioprosthesis is really tall. So stand of the bioprosthesis may be impinge the aortic wall that may dislodge the calcium on the aortic wall at the sinus of our salva. Do you have any trick or any experience about how to manage if you have a calcified acidic aorta, especially at the sinus of our salva near aortic incision? Thank you very much.
Yes, thank you very much. It is a very important question. So when I started to use the trifecta last year, I had the same, you know, questions and the problems I had, because the height of a trifecta is 1 millimeter, higher than the Carpentier, than that of Carpentier Edward, and also Carpentier Edward valve is a little bit, the angle is toward the inside, the trifecta is straight from the annulus, 90 degree, so it may injure the sinotubular junction. I worried about, but. Well, I had an experience of aortic valve replacement with the incisions just above the sinotubular junction for the past 30 years, no changes. When I have some problems of calcification around there or sinus of Valsalva, that's a problem, as you mentioned. Last week, I had one case. When I opened the ascending aorta, the calcium inside of aorta was broke, so I removed all the calciums, including sinus of Valsalva at the non-coronary sinus, and replaced the ascending aorta, including sinus of Valsalva. Because if there is calcification around the sinotubular junction and the sinus of Valsalva, there is no way to close the aorta without any prosthesis. So in those cases, I replaced the trifecta and replace the ascending aorta with the removal of all the calcified tissues.
You mean that you perform the Bentall operation, modified Bentall operation, right?
No.
You place the ascending aorta because if the salva has calcification, coronary artery orifice may have a calcification. It's quite difficult to to put the stitch on.
Yes, it is a very tough case where our indication for Bentar procedure is the position of coronary artery. If the coronary artery ostium is inside of sinus of Valsalva, I do not use the Bentar procedures because it is very difficult. Second, there's high chance of coronary osteal injury when we put the Valsalva graft or straight tube with a Bentar procedure. So in those cases, I remove the ascending, proximal ascending aorta. And if there is some calcifications around the sinus of Valsalva, just above the coronary artery ostium, remove and replace the, with a graft or pericardial tissue. So I do not want to touch anymore around the sinus of Valsalva. So it's very rare. I have, for the last 2 years, I have just one case last week.
Any more question? If not, I would like to thank Dr. Bung Chu Chang. I'm not sure I pronounce correctly or not. And we have 20 minutes left, right? For the break, and you can visit the exhibition outside. Thank you.